NFC East, both playoff teams last year. Recently, they provided some spectacular results. They had it spinning in their last meeting last November, final seconds, Orange Bowl, Miami. A Dan Marino to Mark Cooper pass, 50 yards and a dramatic 21-17 Miami win. That was 85. Today at Giant Stadium, they clash again. Though early, it's already playoff important. And the usual sellout crowd of 76,000 at Giant Stadium. Perfect football weather, partly sunny and 72 degrees in this AFC East matchup, Miami and the Jets. Hello, everyone. Dick Enberg with Merlin Olsen. Welcome to East Rutherford, New Jersey. Both teams are 1-1. Third week of the season. Is that too strong a talk that it has playoff implications?
Dick, I don't think so, because if you want to get to those playoffs, you've got to win the games within your division. The Jets have already lost a game to New England here at home last week. They can't really figure to beat Miami in Miami. This game takes on very great and important proportions to them.
In fact, if New England should win today, the loser of this game will fall quickly two games back. Well, here in New York, the Jets' favorite material has been adhesive and gauze.
Lots of bandages here. Freeman McNeil, their ace running back for the Jets, out on injured reserve with a hyperextended elbow. That really hurts him, because you know that the way you want to beat Miami is to run the football. Puts a lot of pressure on Johnny Hector today.
And the defensive backfield for the Jets decimated. Do they have four healthy players there?
Well, yes, but just barely. Walking wounded. Six Jet defensive backs hurt. That means they had to go out at the first of this week and bring in two extra defensive backs. They've activated them, brought them onto the roster. I had talked to Bud Carson yesterday. Carson said, I don't know. We couldn't even line up four healthy guys out there yesterday.
And they have to face Dan Marino. When Marino throws his eighth pass today, he will rate as the all-time NFL passer in efficiency.
Well, Dick, I got to tell you, if I were Marino, you might see eight of those passes in the first eight plays of the game. He's got to be licking his chops.
Well, you know, his coach Don Shula has it in the game plan.
Well, Shula's comment yesterday, he reminded his players of that loss they took here last year, one of the most embarrassing of his NFL career.
Joe Walton, who was a teammate briefly of Shula. They were both cornerbacks with the Redskins in 1957. Walton with a fine 11-5 year last season. Miami went 12-4 for Shula. Both in the playoffs and were set to go for a moment. Yeah, the wind blows the ball off the tee. Pat Leahy will kick it off. Lorenzo Hampton and the rookie James Pruitt. Pruitt had a 71-yard punt return for a touchdown last week against Indianapolis. They are deep for Miami. And again, Leahy, although the wind is only 10 to 12 miles an hour, apparently down on the field level, gusting strongly enough to knock it off the tee, and this one gets it going toward the sidelines and out of bounds. So Leahy will kick it again from the 30-yard line. He has done most everything right of late. In fact, he has not missed a field goal since that Miami game in the Orange Bowl last year. He's 14 for the last 14.
Kind of hard for both these teams to get it started today. These are two teams that know each other extremely well. Walton and Shula know each other well. These two teams playing twice a year. There are no secrets out there today. They know what to expect from one another, and I think that helps the level of competition. No surprises.
Although, wouldn't you think that Shula is expecting that Walton will have some defensive surprises in that he has to protect that wounded back?
Well, only because no one knows how he's going to try and protect all those wounded warriors back there defensively. And you know that Carson is capable of coming with some interesting derivations to his defense.
Leahy tries it again down the middle, floats it by Davenport. It goes to Hampton at the 15. Lorenzo Hampton is down at the 29. Humphrey, who likes to return kicks of his own, made the tackle, and here comes Dan Marino and the offense of the Dolphins. Lorenzo Hampton and Woody Bennett. Bennett, who was out for 6 hours earlier this week trying to negotiate his contract, he starts today. The Mark brothers, Duper and Clayton on the outside, Bruce Hardy the tight end. The offensive line for Miami reads Cleveland Green, Roy Foster, the all-pro Dwight Stevenson on the nose. He'll be hitting Joe Klecko throughout the day, Ronnie Lee and Greg Cook, the former Packer at right tackle. First down, 29-yard line. Yep, Marino throws on the first play of the game, and he's got a completion to Duper at the 42-yard line. Mel Carter with a tackle, 13 yards for Marino. Defensively, Barry Bennett, Joe Klecko, and Mark Gastineau, the front three. The linebackers, Jackson, Clifton, Mel, and Crable. And then the question marks. Jerry Holmes, starting for the first game, was away in the USFL for a couple of years. Russell Carter at the other corner. Lester Lyles for Harry Hamilton at strong safety. Johnny Lynn, he's nicked in a couple spots, wrist and ankle at safety. Second play, second pass, Marino. Wide open Clayton. He's at the Jets 37 with another first down. It didn't take him long to find his marks. First Duper and then Clayton.
Working on those cornerbacks. The Jets like to play man-to-man on the corners. Last week, New England chopped them up with Stanley Morgan to the outside, and Marino starts out right here. You've got to respect the speed of those two outside receivers, and when you give them that kind of cushion, they'll just stop and come back to that ball. That's a deadly combination.
19 yards on the last pass. Marino 2 for 2 on the ground this time to Hampton for only a couple. Lance Mell and Mark Gastineau collaborated. Well, we're going to see throughout the course of this game one of those ideal matchups in football. You've got an all-pro center, many regard as the best in the game today, Dwight Stevenson of Miami. And many would vote for Joe Klecko as the best nose tackle in the NFL. And they're matched, well, face bar to face bar throughout the course of this afternoon.
It is a nose-to-nose confrontation.
Klecko won the battle the first game here last year, and the Jets with an impressive win, and Stevenson took care of him down in Miami. Flags all over this field. And is it complete or was he out of bounds? It was at the 19-yard line, complete if it counts. And a 16-yard gain to Duper. And now the flags. That early, usually against offense. Motion. Miami. And that will nullify another perfect strike by Marino. The men in the black and white, Pat Haggerty, the referee, and his crew, including the replay official, Tony Viteri, longtime veteran.
Illegal motion, number 68, offense, still second down.
Bud Carson started defensively with a three-man alignment, a 3-4, something they have not done this year. And I think, again, trying to get more of those linebackers in to assist in the secondary. He came in later with the 4-3, and I'm sure they'll mix it up on the day.
Don Shula sends in an extra wide receiver with Duper and Clayton, joined by the veteran Nat Moore, the old-time Dolphin receiver. Moore is far left. It's Moore in motion. A little mix-up in the backfield, and Hampton caught by Gastineau and swarmed down by half the Jets defense way back at the Miami 45. Back at the Jets 45. They don't count the final 10 yards.
Looking down from high up in the end zone, it's a little counterplay, but there's a collision in the backfield right there. One of the wide receivers in motion bumped into Lorenzo Hampton. That allowed Gastineau with his quickness to get a piece of him, and then there was no way to come back. They allowed him his forward motion, but boy, they put about eight Jet defenders on top of Lorenzo Hampton on that play.
Third down, call it a long 19. Marino out of the shotgun for the first time. Underneath, almost intercepted. Bobby Humphrey was the closest Jet. They tried to hit Tony Nathan, and the Jets defense has held.
After a couple of quick successes in the air, Jet defense stiffened. They were able to put that patchwork defensive secondary in the right spots to shut it off.
Reggie Roby, the biggest punter in the National Football League, 243-pounder out of the University of Iowa. And he just sledgehammers the ball, averaged 43.7 in the first two games of this year. Also, as you saw, some problems on returns. Kurt Sohn, 7.5, his average on four returns, is back at the 10. swarming around Sohn, who fair catches at the 11-yard line. 34-yard return. Bobby Humphrey hoping he'll get a chance to take one a long way back. Reggie Roby, we understand, forgot his shoes and borrowed one from the New York Jets to deliver that kick down to the 11, as you see Roby properly adorned.
They're so fussy about those shoes, too. That's a little unusual. Usually they carry them in the handbag. They don't want anybody to touch them.
Dennis Blygen opens with Johnny Hector in the backfield behind Ken O'Brien, and that's Rocky Cleaver in motion. Not much there at all for Blygen, a couple of yards. First check of the scores in the National Football League. No scoring yet as those games are underway. Denver gets a safety early at Philadelphia, and Indianapolis with a quick score against the Rams. Minnesota hits early against the Steelers.
Cleaver came all the way inside to crack on the nose tackle that time. Very unusual play for the Jets.
Second and eight. Hector dancing into the secondary and dropped it to 22. First down Jets. In white, New York lines up offensively this way. O'Brien, part of that great class of quarterbacks in 1983. Hector for the injured Freeman McNeil. Tony Page, although Blygen started for Page, better receiver Blygen. Toon, they love him here. You'll hear a lot of Toon when he gets his hands on the ball. The speedster veteran Wesley Walker. Tight end Mickey Schuler, he's caught 144 the last 2 years. The line of Sweeney, Banker, Fields, Alexander, and McElroy. Same names as late last year, but they're in different positions, three of them. Hector again over the top to the 25, a gain of three. Fields at center, and Alexander was playing with a bad back at right guard in the same spots, but Sweeney, Banker, and McElroy moved around. The Miami Dolphins defense has a couple of rookies, one T.J. Turner from Houston, Bob Baumhauer, the all-pro back at nose tackle, and Little, the other wide man. Brzezinski ship John Offerdahl from Western Michigan. They're really high on that rookie, and Hugh Green, the all-pro. Langford, Judson, Blackwood, and Brown in the backfield. Dennis Blygen for five out to the 30-yard line, where it'll be third and two. Jackie Shipp, number 50 in the Miami defense, to make the tackle.
Just watching Dan Alexander down there. We talked about his back injury. Number 60, right in the middle of your screen. Now, boy, I tell you, he has tried to make his blocks. You saw him throwing down at TJ, TJ on that play. But he is having problems in there. Alexander will probably go as long as he can, but that may not be too long.
Third and two, four plays, four rushes for the Jets. And they stay on the ground again to Hector. A little misdirection, and Hector has a first down at the 33, almost the 34. Well, the Jets, a couple of first downs to get out of the hole.
Number 56, right in the middle of your picture, John Offendahl, and they are so excited about him. He is one of the very quiet, very unassuming young men. Got away with a little hanger on the face mask on that play, but he's calling the defensive signals. You see him stepping into the huddle there with the call from Chuck Studley on the sideline, and he is an impact player. They are thrilled to have him.
I've never heard Shuler use so much praise about a first-year player since Marino checked in. O'Brien's first throw. Plenty of time, and then no one open, and he has to eat it back at the 25-yard line.
And if there's one thing that I'd like to see O'Brien do is to learn how to unload that football. You've heard a lot about it. We've heard a lot about the sacks, and I'm sure O'Brien is tired of hearing about the sacks. But at the same time, there's an awareness factor that you'd like to see him develop. The ability to throw that football away when he knows there's no one open. Marino does that, I think, as well as any quarterback in the league today. And as the on the other side of the spectrum, the least sacked quarterback in football, as opposed to O'Brien being the most sacked quarterback.
62 times last year, and that was the eighth sack against O'Brien this year. Credit Hugh Green with the sack. On second and 13, O'Brien dumps it off, has a man. It's the tight end, Cleaver. Rocky Cleaver from the University of Montana gets 11 before Brzezinski can tackle him from behind.
That ball slightly underthrown. Had it been stretched out a little bit over the top, I think they would have had the first down. Brzezinski able to recover enough to make a saving tackle, at least for the first down. Watch him right here. Had to stop for that ball. If he could have picked it up on the run, kept his momentum, would have picked up at least another 10 yards on the play.
We talked about the all-pro matchup with Stevenson going against Klecko. You saw Bob Baumhauer, also an all-pro, against Joe Fields, the highly regarded center of the Jets. Baumhauer putting pressure on O'Brien. Third down and a short two. And it's going to be close as Hector trying to edge forward. George Little, 99. Defensive right end from Iowa.
He's
going
to be
first.
Short, Dick. They didn't get up to that marker on that play. You talk about Baumhauer. Baumhauer still coming back from knee problems. Is not back to full speed. Has improved each and every week. But he told me, even though his knee actually feels better than it did back in 84, he is not back to full speed at this time.
Baumhauer, one of the many from Alabama, and many spotted on this Miami roster. And of course, Alabama, another theme for Don Shula. Practice yesterday, he interrupted practice several times to say, get me that Alabama score. His son Mike Shula, the quarterback of the Tide. And they were successful yesterday, 21-7.
A lot of Florida players on that team. There might have been a few friendly wagers on that game as well.
A fourth down and less than a yard, as you saw. And the punting team already on. Dave Jennings averaging 37.6 a kick this year. Four times a Pro Bowler himself.
Excellent contrast in Jennings and Roby. Jennings with a net average that is not too spectacular, but with a net average that's much better than his gross average. Kicks the ball with great control, good hang time. They don't get much on the returns.
Nat Moore, as you saw, deep at the 13. Beautiful spiral. Moore, fair catch at the 9-yard line. An excellent kick by the veteran Dave Jennings from St. Lawrence University. Went there as a basketball player and just said, I can kick a football. And here he is now in his 13th NFL year. You'll never get more contrasting styles than the kicking techniques of Jennings and Roby.
Watch Jennings first. Very controlled. The ball at about the shoulder level, even below the shoulder level. Watch Roby. Look how high he starts his drop. A violent kicking action, and yet Roby's foot, his plant foot, stays on the ground. Jennings is up in the air to finish it. That's interesting.
We'll take another look at that. Out of the backfield, Hampton, incomplete. That last punt by Jennings was good for 48 yards to put Miami inside the 10-yard line. And before we go to the kickers, we're just a short punt away from NFL 86.
Dick, here's the opening kickoff in Philadelphia. Junior Tautalatasi bringing it back for the Eagles. Ken Woodard hits him for the Broncos. Mike Harden comes up. The ball squirts free. The Broncos can't recover it. Otherwise, it would have been first and goal to go. Instead, it squirts out of the end zone for a safety. Later, they add a field goal and lead 5-0.
All right, Bob, very timely. We talked about the Denver defense in NFL 86, and already they've produced, in essence, 5 points against the Eagles. Hampton corralled after a gain of nearly five. Lance Nell, Penn State, All-American in on the tackle. Still no score, St. Louis, Buffalo, Atlanta, Dallas. 5-0, a baseball score. The Broncos at Philly, Indianapolis up 7-0 against the Rams. Pittsburgh has tied the Vikings at 7, no score in Detroit. Third down, between 5 and 6 yards for the first down. Six defensive backs in against Marino. Incomplete, and the reason it was, pressure by Gastineau and Lyons on Marino. And Gastineau trying to get the crowd going. The football Samson, number 99, the long-haired Mark Gastineau.
Brings Reggie Roby back onto the field. And they're going to kick out of Reggie Roby. Will start in his own end zone to kick this one away. Should give the Jets good field position.
Watch again how Roby uses that real high release of the ball and then he locks the plant foot down. Most kickers will let that plant foot leave the ground. He just lets him. Sohn at the 50. 40. 30. Kurt Sohn to the Miami 23.
What a great play by Sohn. Wow.
36-yard punt by Roby, and Sohn takes it back 27, and the Jets are in scoring position. Roby may want to give Jennings his shoe back after that punt.
He might at that. Watch this great play. Sohn catches the ball under pressure. Gets away from Mike Smith, 25 there. Away from the tight end coming down. And then just breaks his way up the sideline. And that's such a heady play, an experienced play, knowing when you can catch the ball in traffic and do something with it to help your team get that field position. I'll tell you, they really are tickled to death to have Sohn back and productive. They thought he'd never play again after that severe knee injury.
Roby, the punter, made the tackle just 9 yards past the line of scrimmage for the punt. From the 23, Cleaver in motion. Hector. Johnny Hector from Texas A&M down close to the 15-yard line before Offerdahl. And Bud Brown can make the tackle for Miami. 5 minutes left, first quarter. Let's go to NFL 86.
All right, Dick, a moment ago in Foxborough, Rich Camarillo to punt for the Patriots. The Seahawks' Kerry Justin blocks it. They take over at the 13-yard line, and on the next play, Kurt Warner scores, and the Seahawks have a 7-0 lead in the first at New England.
That's an interesting matchup. Seattle and New England both unbeaten. And Seattle uses the defense to score. O'Brien looking for six underneath. Incomplete to Blygen. He looked long first to Walker in the end zone and then tried to throw underneath.
O'Brien very disciplined in his move from receiver to receiver. They're very careful. They have him structured. You see the look deep. Comes right back there when the deep pass is not open to Blygen. That pass should have been gathered in by Dennis Blygen, who has developed into a very fine receiver out of the backfield, but didn't show you that skill on that particular catch.
O'Brien, who had sensational numbers last year other than being sacked, 25 touchdowns, only 8 passes intercepted, third and a long two. Incomplete, and fortunate for the Jets that was not intercepted on the ricochet. Al Toon was the intended target. Here comes Pat Leahy as the Jets look for his 15th consecutive field goal.
You'd almost like to see a stat that says passes dropped, because it's so unfortunate to credit the quarterback with an incomplete pass in a situation like that, where Al Toon had the ball in his hands and should have made the catch for a first down.
32-yard field goal attempt out of Pat Ryan's hold. Guy Bingham to snap. Veteran Leahy's been outstanding. He's really hitting him, and he's got another. 15 straight. The NFL record, 23. Mark Mosley. Now the Jets have scored first. Ken O'Brien wanted 7, but New York settles for 3. Sohn's 27-yard punt return, setting up the Jets' field goal by Leahy from 32 with 4 minutes 29 seconds remaining in the first quarter here at Giants Stadium. Lorenzo Hampton, 27, and the rookie James Pruitt, 82, await Leahy's kickoff. Hampton at the 10. Has a seam and is across the 30 to the 32-yard line. Now, we talked about Klecko and Stevenson in that matchup, and when they talk about Stevenson, the center for Miami, they all say he's got great hands. That used to be what they talked about, defensive players.
Well, it used to be that the defensive players had their hands as perhaps their only advantage, but now allowing the offensive players to use their hands, and in particular, a man with good, strong, powerful hands and arms, Stevenson neutralizes a lot of the moves of good nose tackles just by getting those hands up quickly and stopping them and making them restart.
And that's for a man, he has to snap the ball and still get those hands up that quickly. If you get a chance, we'll show you how quick he makes that transition. He'd be a magician. Marino, plenty of of time to find Mark Cooper, and he's out of bounds at the 45 of New York. Johnny Lynn made the bump. Ticker, bringing you up to date on all the early games around the National Football League.
We talk about quick hands for the center, Dwight Stevenson. Marino's hands, about as quick as any you'll see. Boy, does he smoke that ball out of there in a hurry.
Cooper to the left, Clayton near side. Woody Bennett. And Lorenzo Hampton behind Marino. Again is Duper, and he's inside the Jets 25. Johnny Lynn makes the tackle. Duper has 21 more yards.
Super Duper. Boy, is he ever. Amazing size. Look at the size of his thighs and hips. Great power in those legs. Boy, does he have speed. You see him there just looping, getting away, and Marino with a wonderful sense of vision. Boy, he sees what's happening downfield, and when a receiver gets open, that ball is on its way.
Duper at 5'9", was a high school basketball center, can dunk with either hand. Marino already 76 yards, and this will be his eighth pass, his 1,500th career pass. And he hits Hampton at the 20. Hampton inside the 10, first and goal, Miami. So Dan Marino with his 1,500th pass, you need that many attempts to qualify, and is the top-rated passer in NFL history. Joe Montana, Roger Staubach, a distant third.
Well, and the Dolphins do such a great job of getting the good isolation. They're trying to get the back isolated on Lance Mell here. They're able to do it, and Mell, who's working on a couple of bad ankles, simply no match for the speed of number 27, Lorenzo Hampton. They're down in scoring position.
13 more yards on the last toss. They have nearly the full 10 yards to go on first and goal. 3.5 minutes left, first quarter. Marino over the middle. Duper, he wanted interference from Lynn. Make that Carl Howard now, who is in that deep secondary. He has just rejoined the Jets. Played with the Cowboys, Houston, Tampa Bay. Jets out of Rutgers.
They like Howard. In fact, Bud Carson very confident that he is going to be able to fit in. But boy, when you've been out for a while, wandered around, and they call you and say, come on back, it takes a while to get back into the swing of things. He was with the Jets earlier in the preseason, cut loose and now reactivated.
Woody Bennett out, so only Hampton behind Marino, and Matt Moore is the third wide receiver. He's lined up tight on the right side. Inside handoff to Hampton did not fool the Jets. He's to the 6-yard line. Marty Lyons. What does he look in great shape? Lyons, a former number one pick out of Alabama in 1979.
Jets have been giving up yardage against the running game this year. Very tough last year. Third best in the NFL. One of the reasons is because of the good techniques in that defensive line. Not only some physical players in there, but they play with sound defensive technique. When you have an anchor like Klecko in the middle, it makes it a lot easier on you.
Four wide receivers, James Pruitt and Clayton on the far side, Moore and Duper on the near side. Jets may have been offside. Third and goal, inside to Pruitt, and the rookie has a touchdown.
Smart move by Pruitt. He was in the doghouse 2 weeks ago, missed the plane out to San Diego, and then dropped two passes in that game, one of them for a touchdown. Came back last week with a big catch and a couple of big punt returns, and here he is in a crucial situation, not only making the catch, but then able to stretch that long body out and stick that ball across the goal line. That'll endear him to Coach Don Shula.
Fourth round draft pick out of Cal State Fullerton. Reve's extra point try is there, and Miami leads for the first time as they march quickly downfield using the Marino pass. He hits Pruitt for his second NFL touchdown. Don Shula has a cleanup hitter in that man, Marino. He produces
41 of 44 games, at least one touchdown pass.
I want to say we're reviewing the sheet that Strzok keeps on the sideline of what plays they run. I want to know what was working, what wasn't working.
Reveille kicks off. Bobby Humphrey deep for the Jets, but it sails to the far side. Michael Harper, former Southern California running back. Harper does not get to the 20. Down at the 17, Crash Jensen. Jim Jensen, the backup quarterback on the special teams. Let's go to NFL 86.
Dick, that orange crush defense that Ahmad talked about on the pregame show strikes again. In Philadelphia, Randall Cunningham to the air, picked off by Mike Harden. 30 yards later, he's in the end zone. And Denver leads at the vet, 12-0 over the Eagles.
That Ahmad Rashad was right on with that Denver defense. Maybe he should pick the games instead of McGuire.
You know, one thing, you win with good defense. You start that march to the championship. The Broncos know that.
O'Brien, the throw, has time and hits Rocky Kleber over the middle. Tight end is out to the 28-yard line. 11 yards and a first down. Kleber, who started today with only one catch in the first two games, has two already in this first period. 2 minutes, 11 seconds left in the quarter. 7-3 Miami.
Jets have been using some double tight end in there. And on that particular play, broke Kleber up inside. They haven't been able to get the ball as often as they'd like to their other big tight end, Mickey Schuler. Schuler not on the same track as he was last year.
Big hole for Blygen, and he rumbles to the 38-yard line. Dennis Blygen, the all-time St. John's scorer and rusher, and the first of the Redmen to make it in the NFL.
Let's go down into the pits and watch Joe Fields working on number 73, Bob Baumhauer. Look at him as he takes him to the outside and drops on his legs, opening the way for Blygen. That's the kind of play, that's an overcommitment by Baumhauer. That's the kind of thing he's got to work himself back out of as he gets into shape.
A little over 10 yards on the carry. Lever again in motion, and then comes in to block on Baumhauer. Oh, my. T.J. Turner of Houston making the hit. A yard gain at best. On the ticker, 3-0 Atlanta scoring. There's a two unbeaten teams down in Dallas. And the Falcons, certainly one of the surprises of this young season. Denver's defense has them a dozen. 7-7, New England comes back in the second at Foxborough. 7-7, the Rams have tied it at Indy. 14-7 Minnesota over Pittsburgh in the first, and Tampa Bay leads in Detroit. Hector ducking through a hole, and Johnny Hector to the 47-yard line. Good game for Hector of 7 yards.
Dick, John Offerdahl is so quick from his linebacking position on that last play, reading in the backfield. Watch him, number 56. Look how he reads it quickly, shoots inside, stacks the blocker right there. That's Tony Page, knocks him on his back. A little too aggressive. Ball carry able to cut in behind that, still found room to run. But you see there the very physical nature of that young rookie.
John Offerdahl, the number 2 draft pick. The Dolphins, and already calling defensive signals for Shula as a rookie. And that is the end of the first quarter here at Giants Stadium, with the Dolphins leading 7-3. Walton's only win last year against Miami here at Giants Stadium. His dad, Tiger, was a player in the NFL going way back and a coach for the Steelers. And his son, they've nicknamed him Tiger, as a junior high school quarterback. Both head coaches have young sons who are quarterbacks. One in college, Mike Shula, and Joe Walton said his youngest is 14. He's already 6 feet 2 inches tall as a quarterback in junior high. Jets with a good drive. Look at third and 1.5. Have a man open. Hector, first down, Miami 43. Hugh Green ran him out of bounds. It's been a good march for the Jets. Let's look at the statistics, Merlin.
Time of possession favoring the Jets in both games last year. A big edge for the Jets in that department. Yardage favoring the Dolphins, as you might expect, with their success over the passing lanes. They have not done much with the rushing attack. They haven't run the ball that often.
No, they haven't. I wonder why. Boy, that's just it's like unlocking the candy store to give Marino a chance to shoot those bullets against such a wounded deep secondary. let's drop this note in that the telecast is presented by authority of the National Football League, intended for the private use of our audience. Any rebroadcast or other use of this telecast without the express written consent of the New York Jets and the National Football League is prohibited.
Looking for a brief moment at Reggie McElroy, right tackle now, used to be on the left-hand side. They're very pleased at the results of moving that young man from the left side to the right side.
Apparently, they're having trouble with the 30-second clock. That was the reason for the delay. In fact, the 10-second clock for 30 seconds, now it's 30. It was a 10.
Starting it out on its own now. Well, that's the way it should be. Shula says, okay, that's all right with me. Now the clock counting down. They're winding it down to 10 seconds. What are we doing here?
We're going to find out.
Okay.
I guess at 14 they decided that's where the time was. Wesley Walker in motion to the inside. First down play and the give to Hector. Hector making a little out of a tough situation. Jackie Schiff had him shut off along with Brodzinski. Offered Dahl finished the tackle. And Hugh Green is down on the far side of the field holding his right thigh. And that's, knee.
Oof. That's something you don't want to see. Certainly the most physical of those linebackers, perhaps with the exception of Offerdahl, quickly out to look at him.
He appeared to be all by himself out there, Merlin.
And like Dick, one of the things that this turf does, it tends to grab your feet, and occasionally you can get hurt just driving on your own.
We'll check on the welfare of Hugh Green when we return. Well, here at Giants Stadium, the concern is for number 55, Hugh Green. You heard Don Shula on NFL 86 comment that his defense was stronger. One of the main reasons they have Hugh Green now. At this time last year, he was at Tampa Bay. But will they have Green for long? The stretcher used to take him off. It appeared that Green was totally away from the play and just caught his shoes on this AstroTurf, and down he went.
Sometimes the traction is just too good on the AstroTurf fields, or the artificial turf fields. And whereas a grass field is forgiving, your cleats will tend to twist in the grass and relieve the pressure. Occasionally on a turf like this, the cleats lock up and you can't get them loose, and you literally tear that knee apart or injure the leg with the weight of your own body and the force of a quick move to the inside or the outside. That may well be what happened to Hugh Green on that play.
It was totally away from the play, and of course, our cameras were all focused on the balls that came to the right side. Much like Kyle Clifton, he turned his knee, the Jets linebacker against New England their last game. Al Toon on an end around gets to the 40-yard line, a gain of 2 for the wide receiver from Wisconsin. 14 minutes left in the half. Here's NFL 86.
Dick, check out this play in Philadelphia. The punter is John Telchik of the Eagles. Now, it's a fake, but he throws it up in the air to make it appear to be a punt. The Denver players peeling back don't realize it. The call is a legal contact by Gerald Wilhite, not pass interference. 5-yard penalty gave the Eagles a first down. Confused?
Oh, Buddy Ryan.
That's a buddy trick.
Third down and 7 for the Jets. O'Brien. Tattoo. Did they get it in bounds? No, out of bounds, and it remains in the possession of the Jets as Al Toon has the first down at the Miami 25.
What a great target he is for O'Brien. O'Brien likes to lead his receivers downfield. Let's go in and see what kind of time he has to throw. Doug Better, 75, trying to break that pocket on the inside. But O'Brien, with time to throw, gets that into the hands of Toon. Look at that ball. Kicked out of bounds, unfortunately.
Yes, Offerdahl, actually his foot unintentionally knocked it out of bounds. And that was a break for the Jets.
Defensive player must control that football. You can't just bounce it out of bounds and expect it to come back into your hands.
Jets trailing 7-3 early in the second quarter. Wide open is Rocky Klaver. He's at the 10. He's at the 5.
It was was Rocky Cleaver that capped that great drive that O'Brien put together in Miami last year that put them ahead with seconds left to go, only to watch Marino and Duper take the game out of their hands. But here's Cleaver again, fighting for that extra. Look at that. Two guys, and they still couldn't put him down.
Took the whole Miami secondary to drag him down. First and goal at the four-yard line. As Cleaver, who is a tight end, special teams, emergency quarterback, he and Jim Jensen.
The common denominator.
I think so. The two most versatile players, perhaps, in the entire NFL.
Jets trying to take the lead. With 12 and a half minutes left, second quarter. Four shots from the four. O'Brien will pass on first down. No one open. Threw it away. Flag down.
A very late flag. And Rocky Cleaver pointing it out, saying that Mike Kozlowski had interfered with him.
Defensive pass interference in the end zone.
Well, that penalty will take it to the one-yard line, first and goal.
Rocky Cleaver here in isolation. And watch Kozlowski, number 40, coming right from the left-hand side of your picture. And he's going to make the contact before the ball is thrown. Look at that. No question about it. The ball actually thrown late, but that is further downfield than 5 yards. It's illegal contact.
Now they mark it at the one-yard line. And with it, a first down on the interference call. Don Shula preaches no penalties. In this case, Kozlowski figured that if he didn't hit the wide receiver or the tight end Cleaver, it would have been a touchdown.
They called it interference, Dick. They put it on the one-yard line.
Hector, touchdown! Jets with a very impressive drive to match the previous scoring rampage of Miami. 9-7, and Leahy's try for the point after, and Shula jawing with somebody.
He's never happy when he sees a team move down the field that way.
Leahy makes it 10-7. 83 yards in 10 plays, 5 minutes plus, and Johnny Hector, number 34, subbing for the injured Freeman McNeil, gives the Jets the lead with his one-yard scoring run. Pat Leahy has it teed up. Lorenzo Hampton and James Pruitt. Pruitt, the touchdown maker on the 6-yard pass from Marino on their last possession. He comes to the near side. Deep, Hampton, and he won't run it out. They'll take it at the 20-yard line. Let's check on the scores. I guess that ticker is hibernation. There it is.
Oh, wait a minute. Okay. Here it comes.
That's a 10-minute ticker plus 10 seconds. Buffalo leading 10-0 against St. Louis, and Dallas's Danny White hits Thornton Chandler a 3-yard touchdown pass. New England has taken the lead against Seattle. The Rams with two quick touchdowns now lead 21-7. Minnesota, a 10-point lead over Pittsburgh. And Tampa Bay, two touchdowns over Detroit. Here it is, 10-7. Jets leading Miami. 12 minutes exactly left in the first half. Marino goes to work. Didn't take him long to score the last time he had the ball. Woody Bennett, nothing. Flags are down. Let's go back to the touchdown scored by Johnny Hector.
A couple of things to look for on this touchdown as you look at the holding call against Miami. Let's look quickly. Watch the pull by Alexander here, who's going to trap. Joe Fields, the center, is going to cut over here.
Holding.
To get the play.
Number 74, offense, still first down.
There's Fields cutting down two men. You see 60 Alexander on the outside, and there inside, a beautiful block by number 81 Griggs. Look at that power by Hector. He is excited about an opportunity to come in again, as he has before, to substitute for an injured Freeman McNeil. And he's doing a fine job in there today.
Now, is there any play, I imagine every coach in the country, as you saw Merlin draw that same play, is there anything like the off-tackle play in terms of just drawing it up and seeing it executed?
When you get blocking like that, you don't see it any better.
Intercepted by Lester Lyles. Lyles at the 20. He's down at the 19, and the Jets are in business. Dan Marino, pressured out of the pocket, stepped up, and then misfired. And Lyles, the second year back from Virginia, has his first interception.
The Jets feel if they can get pressure in Marino's face, they can force him to make the bad play. Lyles gets a little stick right there on Clayton. The ball underthrown as Marino was taking the heat. And Lyles gathers it up, and although he's got a bad ankle, he runs pretty well on that play.
They're leading 10-7. O'Brien, first down at the Miami 19. Hector. Ooh, he hit at the 15-yard line. Coming up from the secondary, Bud Brown and William Judson. A reminder, our viewers will be selecting the Budweiser Most Valuable Player today's game at the conclusion of this contest from Giant Stadium. Gain of 4.5 for Hector.
Mark Brown has replaced Hugh Green on the right-hand linebacking position. Defensively, left hand for, as you would face it, your Jet play.
He wears 51 and they're running at him. They did the last play. Toon in motion. O'Brien stepping up. Ooh. Hitting his tight end again. Mickey Schuler inside the 10.
Schuler's first catch of the day. They've been going to Cleaver. The key to that play was the amount of time that they were able to get for Ken O'Brien. That was a high emphasis item for the new line coach, Brad Radakovich. You see here, they really had to have all day. Schuler was open, and boy, he caught the back end of that football. That is concentration.
Oh, that was a sizzler thrown by O'Brien at short range, and Schuler showing great hands, almost squirted all the way through. First and goal, Jets. Hector up the middle. Hector, touchdown. Intercepts. Hector, 5-yard run. Schuler, 6-yard pass. Hector, 8 yards up the middle. And it's now 16-7, and Schuler unhappy as he prowls the sidelines. Left in the first half here at Giant Stadium, and this partisan crowd delighted by Johnny Hector's 2 touchdowns, a 10-point lead. In less than 2 minutes, the Jets have 14 points. Both on Hector scores from 1 and 8 yards, and Leahy kicks it off with a 17-7 Jets lead. And Leahy into the end zone to Hampton. Hampton stopped at the 12-yard line, and it's suddenly the Jets, who are doing everything right. Bobby Humphrey and Matt Munger make the tackle. Let's go back to Hector's score.
Again, you'll see the guard pull. Alexander pulling, getting a lead block in here. But the key to the play is the fact that Hector is able to cut back against the grain. And Bob Baumhauer, the nose tackle, overruns the play. But watch the cutback by Hector here as he slides inside and just with pure power pulls out of the hands of a couple of prospective tacklers.
They talk about the door just being open, ajar, just a little crack, and Hector dancing his way in. First down, Marino at his own 12. Hampton, second year back from Florida, across the 15, close to the 17, before Clifton and Jackson can make the tackle. Jets leading 17-7. Buffalo a 10-point lead. Atlanta now moves back in front at Irving, Texas. Denver 19-0 big at Philly. New England a 3-point lead against Seattle. Battle of unbeaten there. Rams by two touchdowns at Indianapolis. 17-7 Minnesota and Tampa Bay 14-0 against the Lions. Second and four. Unofficially to Mark Clayton in his fourth year out of Louisville.
Clayton is bumped early on the play by number 28, Carl Howard. Howard, who's expecting help deep, is not there to make the play, but it looked like they were expecting Lyles to get there a little more quickly. Either that or they didn't expect Clayton to get there that quickly.
Or they expected Howard to do a better job of bumping him off.
Something. Got to tell you that Clayton actually outlifted Mark Gastineau in the Superstar competition. He lifted 305 in a military lift at Gastineau's 295. Embarrassed him. How can you think about that for a second?
He's an athlete. 5'9 and 175, lifting almost twice his weight. Marino over the middle, complete. Clayton again. And a flag down, and they may tack on some extra against the Jets.
Face mask call.
Shooting fish in a barrel, Marino.
Number 47.
Holmes, Jerry Holmes. A little extra help on Clayton.
Very difficult to work against a timing pattern like this, and that's exactly what it is. It's the quick slant. And this is something that the Miami Dolphins do so well anyway. There's the face mask call. Really using it as a tackling device, but when you get your hand on that mask, you can expect a flag in the air. Holmes, of course, came back to the Jets from the USFL. His first practice blew out his ankle, and that's something that the Jets have had a great deal of. Joe Walton said, look at that, one day, he's here one day, already he's got ankle disease.
And Russell Carter, the starting cornerback, was one of the few healthy ones. He's been injured and is out of the game for the Jets, and Marino looks at a first down at the New York 22. To the 1 yard line. A flag down as Holmes makes the tackle. And we'll check the call. There is another flag down closer to the line of scrimmage.
Dolphin players motioning that it's against the Jets, and if so, it certainly will be waved
defense,
off.
Illegal use of hands.
They'll decline that penalty and take the ball at the 1 yard line, first and goal.
There you see Bud Carson with the headset, right hand side of your picture, just shaking his head. And I'm sure what he's hoping for is some kind of healthy revival. There is Holmes, man on man on Duper. Carson likes to send his cornerbacks in a bump and run situation. And I'll tell you, that's tough. When you get wide receivers with the kind of speed that the Miami Dolphins have, they can give you fits.
Full backfield, Davenport, Bennett, and Hampton all in there. And it's Ron Davenport, stopped at the line of scrimmage. Kyle Clifton, 59, former TCU star. They scramble after the loose ball.
I think they're fighting for the ball, but I think it is after the whistle. But down there in the trenches, you don't know. You see that ball loose.
The ball is over in the 1 yard line. Look at the mass there. And if you go to look a little to the left, there is the ball. Just sitting right where they weren't going for the ball. They're going after each other. It's like a hockey game for them.
These teams, and again, when you play against the team as often as these two play, you develop some very intense personal rivalries.
Tony Nathan into the Miami backfield. Gastineau urging this New York crowd. Make it tough on Marino on second and goal at the one. Jets tough against that run.
Well, it better be tough here. Their feet are in the end zone.
They like to throw the little swing to Nathan, who's an excellent receiver. Instead, it's a tight end. Touchdown, Dan Johnson. Johnson with his first touchdown of the new season. His third catch.
So much confidence in that passing game and the ability of Marino to get the ball on target and receivers with sure hands. Shula never afraid to use the pass instead of the run in a short yardage situation. You see Bennett, number 34, in motion. He was kind of cutting off some of those bodies, but it was a well-executed quick turnout to the tight end.
Now in less than 10 minutes, we've had four touchdowns scored. Back and forth, and now Reves to try the point after. Second-year man from Bogota, Colombia. He went down home to Bogota in the offseason and did the voice on Super Bowl 20. We've been replaced again. Let's go to NFL 86.
Well, Dick, the buddy system is not working in Philadelphia today. On a tackle-eligible play, John Elway finds Dave Studdard for the two-yard score. For Elway, his sixth touchdown pass of the season. Late in the second quarter, 19-0 Broncos. Back to Dick and Merlin.
Jets leading 17-14, but Marino has moved his team very quickly. The interception, the difference. Here's the touchdown play, a little play action. Marino all the way was going to his tight end Johnson, who made a quick out move and was wide open.
They love the mismatch when they can get a receiver, even a tight end, singled up on a linebacker. They feel it's their advantage, because they know that Marino is one of the most accurate passers in all of football. Quick release, no chance to really cover any ground or close that cushion on the receiver. And Don Shula, who calls all the plays for Miami with a great sense of what will work and what won't work, he is a big plus in that situation.
Now Marino, on the two scoring drives, it took him only a minute 53 in the first drive to go 67. In that last drive, 88 yards in just 2 minutes 24 seconds. And the deep kick will not be run out by JoJo Townsell. First down at the 20. And with 10 minutes gone by, a check of the score. New England now by 10 over Seattle. Merlin, we're going to be out at Mile High Stadium next Sunday. We could see two unbeaten teams, New England and Denver. That could be a most interesting matchup with plenty of time to go. 17-14. Jets with the ball and the lead. Whoa, Hector smothered this time as Mark Brown, number 51, invaded the Jets' backfield.
George Little, defensive end on the right-hand side, also in there very quickly. And the two of them just swallowed up that running play. Jets really want to run that football. They count on establishing the running game because they love the play-action passing, which is O'Brien's long suit, really.
Second down, 10. And Hector on the ground. Wrapped up at the 21-yard line. Good pursuit. Brzezinski, 59, along with Offerdahl, the rookie middle linebacker.
Thanks again, Dick. After spotting the Seahawks a 7-0 lead, the Patriots come back and lead 17-7 after the veteran Stanley Morgan beats Dave Brown of the Seahawks and hauls in this 27-yarder from Tony Eason. Late in the second, Pats 17, Seahawks 7.
Morgan, who had 8 catches and over 100 yards in the win against the Jets here a week ago Thursday, hot again. And McNeil is inside the Jets 15. McNeil from Alabama, his 13th career interception. And again, one of those balls bouncing around.
JoJo Townsell, the intended receiver, and this one goes right through his hands. O'Brien has the ball on target, although it is high. Let's talk about that briefly. But a great job of juggling there as McNeil shows his reactions. He's missed a lot of time with injuries. Comes back strong on that play. Johnny Hector there to make the stop downfield. But Miami, after coming roaring down the field, with an excellent opportunity to go ahead in this ball game.
They trail 17-14. First down at the 13 of the Jets. 17-yard return by McNeil. Woody Bennett. Lance Mell, the welcoming party.
You had a chance to hear on our pregame show a little bit about Woody's plight. Upset about the way negotiations are going. Said he may not even play in this game, but it was something he didn't want to do. He's a young man who wants to play football, and he feels like he's caught in the middle.
Yeah, as you heard Don Shula related yesterday, you really sensed a lot of empathy on the part of Shula that it has been frustrating for Ben. He just wants to get it. It's that unknown. He wants to get it settled.
And that's hard on any player, especially one who's conscientious.
Second down, a long 10. Marino going for 6. Duper has a touchdown. There would have been a penalty anyway. Duper fading into the near corner against Carl Howard.
Marino again showing that excellent vision.
Illegal contact. Defense. Decline. Touchdown is good.
And some hard jaws on the other side of the field that belonged to Bud Carson, defensive coordinator. There you see the bumping going on that last play. Carl Howard, no question about that, didn't bother Duper as he was able to bring both feet down just barely in bounds. There you see one of the Marx brothers. I got to tell you, defensively, when you can put that kind of speed on the field and stretch a defense, scares you to death.
Well, Duper set a Miami record with 217 against the Jets last year. Reves adds the extra point. It's 21-17. He already has, Cooper has 91 yards in the first half on 5 catches and a touchdown today.
Credit that Miami line. You see the containment in the middle on Joe Klecko. They were able to keep Gastineau out from the other side. There's the tap dance by Duper down the sideline. Let's watch his feet, Dick. See, it looked to me in the first replay that there was no question about having both of them down. 1 foot down.
You can't win.
I believe it is. You can see a little touch of black there, but that's, when I said tap dance, toe dance, there it is. You see the toe just barely in, a slight touch of black there. If they were looking at that, Tony Viteri's probably over there saying, hey, we got that one right, guys.
He would have had it with a naked eye. He's one of the best.
Yeah. Well, there's Marino on the sideline.
Well, let's see. Marino's taken 1 minute, 53 seconds to score. Then he went 88 yards and 224. Needed 45 seconds to take advantage of McNeil's interception and another quick 7. So with 5 minutes, 6 seconds left in the half, 21-7. And Dwight Stevenson being attended to, that left side.
You saw him controlling Klecko with help on that last play, and that's so important for the Dolphins offense.
Reves, high spinner at the goal line. Bobby Humphrey has a seam. Ooh, couldn't quite squirt through it. Look at it, 4 Dolphins down, and the last one nicked him, Mike Kozlowski.
Humphrey, who so impressed the coaches on the Jets staff with his aggressiveness on special teams, has been moved from wide receiver to defensive back. They have high hopes for him.
Well, we talked about the injuries suffered by the Jets throughout the course of the preseason and the first 2 games, and there is that mash list that Carter heard again today. Johnny Hector on a little swing and diving to the 39-yard line and a first down. Hector, not exactly a long jump technique, but that was his 4th in college. He was a 26-foot long jumper. In fact, in the Southwest Conference, finished 2nd 1 year to a young man named Carl Lewis in Houston.
Dick, I don't think Hector is as nifty at avoiding tacklers before you get to the line of scrimmage as is Freeman McNeil, but he is a better runner once he breaks into the open.
Hector gets the call again. Look at that. Ran into a crack and right on going. Ronnie Brzezinski nailed it at the 43-yard line.
You mentioned that if you want to beat Miami's defense, you have to be able to run that football.
50 yards now for Johnny Hector, who's given a breather, and the Dolphins have rushed only 5 yards. Well, they really haven't tried much, only 6 rushes, with Marino finding all kinds of room to throw.
Hector finally getting a break on the side.
T.J. McElroy may have been holding.
Got his head down a little bit. T.J. Turner pushing from the outside. Rookie giving him a lot of heat.
Holding, number 68, offense declined, third down.
He got the 10 yards and the loss of down anyway. So they declined the hold on McElroy. And from the 35-yard line, it'll be third down and 13.
That's where Marino has a big edge over O'Brien. That's in the ability to do something when the play breaks down. Marino just with a better sense, I think, of what's happening downfield. But that's something that O'Brien, I think, will grow in as he gets more experience.
He needs 13. He's going. He's wide open. Wesley Walker. The Jets have taken the lead again. Oh, my. Walker was 15 yards in the clear.
Did a great job on that play of looking off the defense, looking to his left, and then turning back and without a batting an eyelash, firing that ball deep. We'll show you the replay momentarily. But look at Shula, who is frustrated. And I'm sure what happened is Brown, who's playing back there in that safety position, read the quarterback's eyes, went to his right, only to turn back around and see Walker deep behind him.
Definitely somebody made a mistake in that secondary, blew the coverage because Walker was all so. Leahy adds the extra point. It's like a ping pong match. 3 minutes and 12 seconds left in the half, and the Jets are back in front, 24-21.
Let's look at O'Brien. Now watch him. He'll have his eyes to the left. Watch him here. Looking left, and then snaps back and fires the ball. Able to pull Bud Brown off on that play, and Wesley Walker, who has been nursing supposedly a hamstring injury all week, looked pretty fast on that one.
He could have scored walking on his hands. He was that far open.
Blew by Paul Langford, who's expecting deep help. Nobody home.
Walker looking around as if to say, somebody ought to be closer. Was there a mistake? Is this one going to count? Studley, the defensive coordinator of the Dolphins. Walker, a groin pull in practice this week, but he can run half speed and score on that kind of an opening.
In fact, they held him out of practice for the last part of the week, but strictly a precautionary measure. He knew he was going to be in there today, and what an impact.
35 points scored in the second quarter. Jets lead 24-21. 3 minutes, 9 seconds left. Here comes Hampton. And Lorenzo down at the 24-yard line. Bobby Humphrey made the tackle. Yeah, all the scoring right here at Giants Stadium. Halftime, Buffalo leads 10-0. Dallas has taken the lead 14-13 on a Timmy Newsom 2-yard run. Denver big at Philadelphia. New England still up by 10, and the Rams lead by 2 touchdowns at Indy. 10-point lead Minnesota, and at halftime, Tampa Bay 11 over the Lions.
The one thing you know about the Miami Dolphins is that with Marino and with all of that speed, they can come back so quickly. Here you see the comparison of the two quarterbacks today. Numbers excellent for both quarterbacks. Much of that yardage for O'Brien in that last play.
Marino to Hampton. Ooh, we saw his helmet just snap back as he was hit.
Marty Lyons. And that's great pursuit to see those defensive linemen chasing the quarterback. Ball goes over their heads, and they want a piece of that tackle. Watch the end of the play here. You see the little toss to Lorenzo Hampton. He gets into traffic, coming from the left-hand side of your screen, right there. Whap! Boy, I'll tell you, that's a sandwich job.
First down, 17 yards for Hampton. Well-executed pass by Marino. It's Dan Johnson who has a touchdown, and Kyle Clifton with a tackle out at the 46-yard line, close to another first down.
We talked about the comparison of these two quarterbacks, and another comparison, Marino can throw with his feet in any position. O'Brien has to set up.
First down again.
Whoop.
Down goes Marino.
I don't know if he can throw from there.
No. About the only place he can in the two-minute timeout at 1:58. And Marino trying to hurry to get a playoff before that two-minute timeout. And actually, maybe Hayes did make waste for the Dolphins.
Looked like he hooked the foot of one of his guards, or perhaps his center, and he's limping a little bit. Marino has bad knees, and you see how big those knees are. Well, that's not knee. He wears a knee brace in there. You can see part of that hanging out. Let's see if we can see what happens. There's the guard right there. Stepped on the back of his foot. Roy Foster, 61, nailed him, took him down.
At halftime, NFL 86 scores and highlights. It'll take them a whole halftime just to have the highlights of this game.
We have had some action here. The two teams really getting at it here today.
Wholesale takes out, takes out the ball and puts
in
the wide receivers.
And you see the changes for the defense as well. And they,
Marino. Lots of time, and Duper unable to get to the ball. He was covered by Davlin Mullen. He's playing injured.
These sidelines and the coaches really alert to that kind of thing. A quick change of personnel, which means you might be outmanned on the field. And you saw how quickly the Jets countered with their own personnel in that situation. They were able to just barely get Barry Bennett, number 78, off the field. He's sprinting for that sideline. And of course, if the ball is snapped before he gets there, it's a penalty with too many men on the field.
Third down, 17. Jets lead 24-21. 1 minute, 53 seconds, as you can see, remaining in the first half. Marino buying some time. He has the completion, but far short of the first down as Kyle Clifton makes the hit on the rookie James Crook. Well, fourth down, and Miami will have to give up the ball. The clock is running. The Jets are not using a timeout, and they have all three. A lot of fans here are calling it. Of course, Miami will just let that clock tick away. It was at 1:38 when they could have called time. And there's still 20 seconds on the 30-second clock.
Well, maybe they figure it's a trade-off. They'll use the timeouts to get it stopped later.
Roby spirals it. Kurt Song, he's had one fine return, but not this time. He's down at the 16-yard line with 1:07.
Excellent special teams play by Mike Smith, number 25, down there to tackle Sohn. You see Joe Walton sending the play in with his quarterback right here.
1:07 left in the half. They're just trying to add to the three-point lead. Pat Leahy, who has a field goal in this game, the difference. But he's a long way from the uprights at the moment as the ball is back at the Jets' 16-yard line. We'll see how Joe Walton plays it. Will he play it safe? He's got three timeouts and 1:07. Fearful that maybe three incomplete passes would give Miami and Marino a chance to get the lead at the half. Will he stay on the ground or will he throw it? We're about to find out. Over the middle, the Shuler incomplete, covered by Paul Langford.
T.J. Turner coming in from his left defensive end position to put some heat on O'Brien on that play.
They're x-raying Hugh Green's kneecap, we understand. That was the injury to the kneecap.
Right knee. We have no final report on that, but he certainly is not returning to the field. Anytime you go off on a stretch, you're going to be concerned.
Swings it out of the backfield, incomplete to Blygen. And 59 seconds left. So here's a case where Joe Walton almost couldn't win. If he runs out the clock, they're going to boo him for not trying to get more. If he throws three incomplete passes and Miami gets the ball, they're going to have time to take the lead.
Now, one thing you do know is that you don't want to turn the ball over. So the passes he's thrown have both been high percentage passes. One to the tight end and O'Brien throwing it down low so that Shuler couldn't get it. The defense couldn't either. And that particular little swing, again, high percentage pass. Third down. Let's see what he does here.
Ooh, terrific hit at the 17-yard line, and Miami immediately calls time with 51 seconds, now 50 seconds left.
Paul Langford, number 44, leveling Hector on that play, and we may see the Dolphins go after this punt.
They're going to get pressure.
pretty good field position, Merlin, even with a decent punt.
And certainly with Marino, again, we relate to the kind of speed he has to deal with. Looking, I believe, at Shula, Don Shula, and his son David right behind him, talking to the wide receivers and secondary.
Dave Jennings running for only the second time. He had a 48-yarder his first time. Back to return, James Pruitt. Remember last week against Indianapolis, Pruitt took one back 71 yards for a touchdown and had another punt for 35 yards that he returned.
That one almost broke for TD, too. So he is dangerous.
They have 10 men on the line of scrimmage. Jennings will deliver from around his 9-yard line. Dying spiral, fair catch for Pruitt. Runs into his own man, and the Jets have the football. It can't be returned, although Matt Munger will go all the way to the 2-yard line. That you cannot advance the ball. That's a muff, not a fumble. It cannot be advanced, but apparently will be the Jets' ball at midfield.
Now the question is, did that ball strike the receiver? It would appear that it may have done. There was a collision on the sideline and an awareness problem, and yes, it did. It bounced off the receiver. Let's watch what happened on that last play as Pruitt, with his concentration on the ball, runs into one of his blockers who was not aware of where he was on the field. Right there. That's Thompson, number 24, Renee Thompson, streaking down. Thompson, the one who pulled Munger down from behind. But Pruitt, with his concentration on the ball, didn't feel him there. Collision, ball goes over to the Jets.
Big break for New York. It appeared that the ball hit Thompson's hand after Pruitt ran over his teammate's back. So a little extra present for the Jets and Coach Joe Walton. 42 seconds left in the half, and they have it at their own 49.
Here's another angle of that play, and you see that, oh, the ball hit the hand. Renee Thompson's hand, as he stuck it out there, the ball bounced away from his hand.
Brian going deep for Walker. Wesley Walker scores again. Offensively in this first half, and there's going to be some fireworks down in Shula's locker room at the intermission. Two catches for Wesley Walker, two touchdowns, 115 yards, 65 and now 50 yards on the scores. Leahy gets another, and certainly a gift touchdown for the Jets, who move up 31-21.
A pass right in the seam, perfectly thrown by O'Brien to Wesley Walker, who's between two defenders. And in this kind of situation, at least you've got to get the man down. Langford misses there, and then goodbye, Wesley. He simply outruns Don McNeil to the goal line.
Well, Marino has 34 seconds.
Beautiful pass.
O'Brien, an absolutely perfect strike, and Walker with all that speed dances in with another.
And listen to this crowd.
Now, Lyle's pass interception early in the quarter triggered a quick touchdown as he returned to the 19, and now the recovered muff at midfield leads to a one pass, one play, 50-yard score.
And I'm sure that Chuck Steadley on the sideline trying to figure out how in the world he's going to get his defense back together faced with the additional loss of Hugh Green. He's got to be a very unhappy man at the moment.
Marino says, hey, 34 seconds. A couple more touchdowns could be scored before we hear the gun. That ties the Jets record, 28 points in a quarter. Hampton at the five. Lorenzo Hampton, fumble!
No, they roll the ball, was down. Down at the 27-yard line.
30 seconds for Marino.
You don't want to look away from the field, Dick. You're going to miss, the big plays.
52 points scored in the second quarter. You see it again.
Oh, my.
Oh, he was losing control of the ball. And it would appear that that could have gone as a fumble.
Man, with the book under his arm, Larry Pasquale, the defensive, or the coach of the special teams for the Jets, excited, I'm sure, by the play of his troops.
Doesn't tie a record. That establishes the most productive 15 minutes in Jets history against the Miami Dolphins. Well, we said they've had things spinning, these two teams, and right through the hands of the veteran Matt Moore. Boy, they had the two wide receivers, Pruitt and Clayton, clearing deep. And more underneath, so he had those two men as blockers downfield.
Shula in the past has used three wide receivers and Joe Rose, but with Rose on IR, he's gone more and more to four wide receivers. There's Carson on the sideline. Bud Carson, he's, hey, settle down. We don't want to see any more points in this half.
Again, it's the triple left formation. Pruitt, Clayton, and Moore. Tony Nathan at the 34-yard line. Miami will not call time, trying to get a playoff without a huddle. 18. Dolphins have two timeouts left. Screen to Nathan, weaving his way to a first down at the 45 and a timeout with 2 seconds left in the half.
Marino obviously wanting that last play. Of course, if they're able to get a penalty or able to get a lucky bounce down there, then maybe they can put some points up before the half. But oh, we've seen a shower of points in this game.
Don Shula yesterday and again on the pregame show today indicated that after his team's defense was shredded by the Chargers in the opener, 50-28. He said what psychology here was, we started our season last week against Indianapolis. That 50-point game, that happened some other time. But after a 30-10 win against the Colts, his defense has coughed up 31 points in the first 30 minutes today. How about the other points? Elsewhere, Buffalo 10-0 already in the third period. Dallas at the half by 8 over Atlanta. Denver, big lead at the half of Philadelphia. New England and Seattle, very important game. Two teams have won their first two games. And the Rams looking for a 3-0 start. Minnesota 10 over Pittsburgh and Tampa Bay leading Detroit 14-3. Now the back four, the Jets way back at their 30-yard line. There's five more yards for Marino.
Tom Baldwin on the nose, off too quickly. And Dick, while we have a second, as they sort that penalty out, Hugh Green apparently will not come back into the ball game.
Encroachment, number 95, defense.
They are going to take further x-rays when they get back to Miami, but it is an injury to his right knee. And I think that one of the reasons that this defense has had so much trouble today, speaking about the Miami defense, is the injury to a man who's a very emotional leader out there, a very physical player, Hugh Green. He's not the only problem. His absence is not their only problem.
And 50 yards from a score in the final play, a less penalty for Marino and the Dolphins. And we all know what this one's going to be. Send him deep, give Marino enough time to get one high and deep to the end zone. Here it is. Locked around and intercepted by the Jets.
Johnny Lynn.
Johnny Lynn with his first interception of the year.
Cast it all, and he pulled it up.
And the Jets fans cheer their team off the field. Wesley Walker, two catches, two bombs, two touchdowns, and the Jets leading 31-21.
And after a couple of performances that were less than inspiring for the Jets. Certainly last week's loss, not a good game for the offensive team. O'Brien has shown some real spark here and has used some offensive tools to great advantage as they put up 31 points and take that 10-point lead into the locker room.
And that's not overlooked, the performance by Johnny Hecker replacing the injured Freeman McNeil. Two touchdowns himself and 50 yards rushing. And, of course, Marino, he's got three touchdown passes. We can only expect more of the same in the second half. NFL 86 halftime activities will continue in a moment. We'll be right back after these messages from your local station. Well, if you're Don Shula at halftime, say we scored 21 and we're down by 10.
Well, I don't think either defensive coordinator is going to be very happy in that locker room. You better believe there are some adjustments being made. They've got to play better defense, both teams, if they expect to win, because these offenses are both playing very well.
Well, you expected the Jets, with all their injuries in the secondary, to have their problems, and they did in stopping Marino's passing game. But how about the Dolphins' defense? Will they shore it up in the second half? Well, we'll soon learn. First, we go to NFL 86 in New York.
Whew. We welcome those of you who've watched that Dolphins-Jets first half, and what a half it's been. 31-21 in favor of the Jets. We'll go right to highlights of that game, then update you on what's going on elsewhere. Offense, the story of the half, except for this. Hugh Green being taken off, x-rays on his kneecap, and as soon as we know something or Dick and Merlin have information, we'll pass it along to you. Johnny Hecker, a couple of first-half touchdowns for the Jets. This one was an 8-yarder in the second quarter, gave them a 17-7 lead. But Dan Marino threw three touchdown passes in the first half, one to James Pruitt, one to Dan Johnson, this one to Mark Duper. It was the third, and they had the lead at that point, 21-17. Then the combination of O'Brien to Walker went to work. Just over 3 minutes to play in the half, and a 65-yarder to Wesley Walker. It's 24-21 Jets, and it looked like that would be the halftime score. Then, with less than a minute to play, a Dave Jennings punt is botched by the Dolphins. Two of their players collide. The ball hits one of them, bounces free. Jets recover. They take over at midfield, and let's listen to Dick Enberg.
Brian going deep for Walker. Wesley Walker scores again.
To make it 31-21 at the half, Denver is crushing Philadelphia at the Vet. 26-0 is the score there, and it looks as if Dan Reeves and company will go to 3-0 and thus put more pressure on the Raiders, who are 0-2 and at home later today against the Giants. The Orange Crush defense, featured by Ahmad Rashad on the pregame show, that's been the story. Randall Cunningham's pass intercepted by Mike Harden. In all, they forced three first-half turnovers from the Eagles. Harden brings it back 30 yards for a touchdown. 12-0 Broncos in the first quarter. On the alternating quarterback system, Cunningham is out. Jaworski is in for the Eagles. Makes no difference. Rick Dennison hits him. He fumbles. Broncos recover. Later, a tackle-eligible play works for Denver. Nothing failed for them in the first half. Number 70, Dave Studdard, is eligible. He latches on to Elway's sixth touchdown pass of the season. Sammy Winder had a 4-yard scoring run later to make it 26-0. So you were right on the money in the pregame show.
I tell you, Bob, in Denver, they really have it going. I had a chance to talk to linebacker Tom Jackson, who's been around for 14 years, and he said it's really a pleasure to finally be on a team that the defense didn't have to carry. Now, when the offense scored 38 points against the Raiders a couple weeks ago, it really gave a boost to that defense. They are very confident. I spoke with Carl Mecklenburg, and he says they have the best defense in the entire NFL. Now, here's a stat that I bet you didn't know, Paul, is that Joe Collier's defense has allowed the fewest touchdowns in the NFL in the last 10 years, over the last 10 years.
I knew that.
You did?
Oh, I'm sorry.
You think Denver's defense is better than the Bears?
I don't know, Bob. That's pretty tough to say. I think that they have a strong defense. They're in the top three defenses in the league, between them, New England, and the Bears.
Well, maybe Denver and the Bears will have a chance to settle it in the Super Bowl. Continuing with the scores, Dallas is in front of Atlanta. They've reached halftime in Dallas. Danny White is playing. That had been questionable, but he's thrown a couple of first-half touchdown passes. 21-13 is the score. They go to the third in Buffalo. The Bills now lead the Cardinals 10-3. The Cardinals just got a field goal. The Patriots and the Seahawks to the third quarter. The Patriots trying to go 3-0. Seahawks also came in 2-0 on this wet and foggy day in Foxborough. The Patriots lead at 17-7 now early in the third. It didn't start well for them. Kerry Justin blocks Rich Camarillo's punt, and the Patriots give the ball up at the 13-yard line. On the very next play, the Seahawks, with possession, score as Kurt Warner goes in from 13 yards out, and a short-lived 7-0 lead for Seattle. but Tony Eason has had a good first half. On this first quarter drive, a 22-yard scramble keeps the drive alive and eventually sets up a 6-yard scoring run by Tony Collins that ties the game at 7. After a 26-yard field goal by Tony Franklin gave the Patriots a 10-7 lead, they pad it to 17-7 as Stanley Morgan, who's having an outstanding season thus far, latches onto the 27-yarder from Eason, and they go to the third, 17-7. The Rams spotted the Colts a 7-0 lead, then they roar back to lead 21-7 at halftime at the Hoosier Dome. Steve Bartkowski has thrown his first touchdown pass of the year for L.A. Minnesota and Pittsburgh at Minnesota, the Vikings with a 17-7 lead. Two Tommy Kramer touchdown passes to rookie Hassan Jones. Tampa Bay playing at the Silverdome against the Lions and leading 17-3. It might not be much longer before we see Chuck Long at quarterback for Detroit. But now let's talk about the Patriots, and you rank them, contrary to what Ahmad says, you rank the Patriots ahead of the Broncos.
I think, you know, I still think that two Super Bowl teams are going to be Chicago and New England by Denver. But no. New England, they just play an awesome defense. They really are. The one block punt by Seattle and it's 13 yards, they get a touchdown. That ended it. If you get the people that were watching that first half of that game, Bobby, Seattle can't do anything, and they can't stop New England because of their running game and the great passing.
Denver and New England play next week on NBC. You guys want to get your wagers in now?
Low scoring game is all I'm going to say. New England win it.
Hedging a week ahead of time. Huh?
They'll sort it out as we pause here for station identification, and we'll be back after this from your local station. NFL 86 will continue at halftime in a minute.
Welcome back to Giants Stadium, where the New York Jets lead the Miami Dolphins 31-21. They wanted to run the ball, the Jets, against Miami's defense, and with Hector, 53 yards. They have accomplished that part of their scheme.
Well, they certainly have, and it's given them some balance that has allowed them then to be much more effective in throwing the ball. Neither team playing much in the way of defense. And I think if one of these defenses can get themselves going the second half, they can make their team the winner.
Let me throw one at you that really is kind of startling. Don Shula is in his 17th year as head coach of the Miami Dolphins. He has never, in his previous 16 years, lost two of the first three games. Should the Jets beat Miami today, it would mark a negative milestone for Shula. And you know that, well, you can see right now, he's pumped already. He was out with his team, and he had him out here early. Yeah. Usually a sign that they don't want to hang around the coach's words.
I don't blame him. I'm sure in that locker room, he was very forceful. He is not a man who sits around and says, gee, maybe I should say something to these players. He's explosive. He's emotional. And I'm sure he let them know exactly how he feels. On the other hand, I don't think Bud Carson held back over in that Jets locker room either, although he has got a lot of problems to deal with injury-wise. He still can't be happy with his team giving up 21 points.
But don't you figure in the second half that Miami is going to score? I mean, the Jets have some problems defensively. You figure Miami is going to score. The key, really, to the half is, can Miami hold down the Jets?
Yes, and can the Jets' offense continue to be productive? They really needed this day. They did not play well last week. They were not spectacular in their opener. And O'Brien, in particular, has had a pretty darn good first half. Those two long passes to Walker, beautiful strikes. And I'm sure that the Jets are impressed with and happy about the improvement there.
And the Jets are going to get the ball first here in the second half.
Let's take a quick peek at the statistics for that first half, which I'm sure are going to be a little interesting. Explosive numbers. You look at 5 yards rushing for Miami. 238 through the air. The team's pretty close total yardage. Turnovers, 3 by the Dolphins, 1 by the Jets. And boy, those turnovers will kill you. And again, the time of possession favoring the Jets. I think that's an illustration of their ability to run the football. And you always try and keep Marino on the sideline. That's one way to defend against the Miami Dolphins offense, is to keep control of that football and keep him on the sideline.
Get an early clue as to any adjustments that Shula and his defensive coordinator Studley have made at halftime as the Jets get the ball with that 10-point lead to start the second half. Humphrey deep along with Michael Harper, and on the near side, JoJo Townsell, as Fouad Rebaez will kick it off for Miami. They scored 68 points in their two games last year. They've scored 52 in the first half today. Humphrey will take it at the 20 on the touchback.
Humphrey down to the kick in the end zone for a touchback.
tenths of a yard isn't a bad situation for an offense.
They have hit some big plays, obviously, on those first down situations. Those are the kind of stats that a defensive coordinator brings in and lays on the table on a Monday morning and says, something I want to talk to you guys about. We have not seen great defense by any means in this first half.
Rocky Cleaver and Mickey Schuler, two tight end start, with Cleaver used way out to the near side. Altoon split to the right. Johnny Hector. And he noses forward for a couple. John Offerdahl, 56 on the tackle. Both teams are aware that New England with a 10-point lead going into the second half, as the Patriots try to jump out to a 3-0 start. That would mean the loser of this game would fall two games back after just 3 weeks of the AFC East.
Perhaps it doesn't even need to be said, Dick, but so important to come out in the second half and establish yourself. That's certainly not a dramatic play for the Jets to begin with. Let's see if they can't get something going here. You've got to get a drive going here if you want to control the second half.
O'Brien going long for Toon, and that'll be interference. No incidental contact, and the Jets bench is furious.
Some of the Jets players and coaches quickly on the field to argue it, and Walton is absolutely livid.
It appeared that Toon was just breaking into the clear when tripped from behind by Paul Langford.
Here it is, and watch Toon. The key here, if Langford's head is turned away from the receiver, and the official determines that he is not aiming his feet, in other words, he doesn't know where that receiver is, they're not going to make that call. And that's the way it was called in that situation.
The replay seemed to support the official. Third and eight. O'Brien looking deep again. Then has to just flip it out to Schuler, who remarkably handles it for a 5-yard gain out to the 27, short of a first down.
Kind of pass with that.
Like one that I threw.
Shot foot pass. Mickey Schuler took his time to get that controlled and almost got down there far enough to pick up the first down. But the first drive ends rather abruptly after that call that the officials seem to be very sure of. The Jets, of course, very angry on the far sideline, as you would expect in a situation like that.
Jennings, two punts, very productive. One that went 48, no return, and the other was the one in which Pruitt muffed it, and the Jets recovered at midfield and quickly scored on the Walker touchdown from O'Brien. He spirals it towards James Pruitt, and the rookie has it at the 35, and down he goes at the 38. Marion Barber got him. 36 yards on the kick, 3 yards on the return.
Renee Thompson down on the field. He's up now, limping off the Jets defense. Now we'll get a chance to see if what Shula has cooked up offensively. As you see, Bud Carson, defenses and offenses both signaled in for both of these teams from the sideline. It's a dying art to call those on the field anymore.
Marino starts from his own 38. No surprise here. To the air. The Jets had two or three shots at it. Meanwhile, back at the 19-yard line, Lyons and Marino discussing future stock options. With that tip drill, it looked as if the Jets had a sure interception.
Marty Lyons, I think, still smarting. He was one of the players out on the field. This is back in action. You see Lyons out there to argue with the official. Barry Bennett, number 78, out there. And the official said, hey, you want a penalty? Get back off the field. There's Radakovich coming out to grab a hold. And there is Walt meeting him on the sideline.
Reno lucky that ball isn't in the possession of the
Jets.
That
was volleyball.
Inside handoff to Tony Nathan. Across the 45 to the 46, where it'll be third and two. Wiles and Gastineau with the tackle, and Mark Gastineau. His name has really not erupted often in this game. It's
Gastineau switching sides in this defense, occasionally going to the inside, but the Dolphins have done a good job of forcing him wide. He has not been a big factor in the pass rush. Klecko more effective, I think, in breaking the pocket from the inside, but he has had a hard day, too. They have been doubled, both of them, all day long.
Gastineau lined up at defensive right end, Klecko to his left. Marino drilling it for a first down. Clayton at the 47 of the Jets, a 6-yard gain and a first down. Mill and Humphrey with a tackle.
You asked the question about both Gastineau and Klecko. There they are on the right side. Foster 61 and Stevenson inside. You see Cleveland Green, number 74, containing Gastineau on the outside. And as you were able to see on that replay, Dan Marino with plenty of time to get that ball off.
First down at the Jets 48-yard line. It's 31-21, New York. 11:42 remaining in the third quarter. Able to run effectively. Marty Lyons stopping Woody Bennett after a yard, maybe 2 yards. Lyons, first round pick of the Jets back in 1979.
You see that cock position for Joe Klecko, and he's so quick in sliding through inside. Even if he doesn't make the play, he disrupts a lot of things inside. Lyons, as you mentioned, over quickly. The mark of good defense is great pursuit. How many people can you get on that ball carrier? Play, there was some good defense play, but
again, again on second and eight, and offside. Klecko, Marino will go through. This is a free play, and he's got Duper wide open for a touchdown. We'll check the officials, and
I think it's offsides on the Jets.
Number 73, decline, touchdown.
46 yards on the touchdown, and it's now 31-27.
I'll tell you, it's a mistake that you see so often at every level of football. You don't expect it at the professional level. The flag does not stop the play. You got to continue to go. You see Klecko offsides there. Jerry Holmes one-on-one on Duper. And here, Marino has all day to get that ball deep. Duper just broke off the pattern. Looked like he was running a post. Decided to break it deep. And Marino, with that great downfield vision, able to see the play and get the ball off.
Gervais tacks on the extra point. And as expected, Marino and the Dolphins through the air get a quick seven again as Mark Duper has his second touchdown reception. That's the fourth TD pass by Marino.
It's got to be frustrating for Klecko.
The game back to a three-point contest. New York Jets lead is cut to three as Joe Klecko and defensive group talking things over. A little lurch offside. Everyone relaxes, and Mark Duper had an easy 46-yard touchdown. Reveille, this one's a little shorter than his pass kicks, and it's Humphrey at the four. It'll be Humphrey. A nice running by Humphrey to the 28-yard line. Cooper celebrating his second touchdown. Let's see who's scoring elsewhere. Let's go to NFL 86.
Dick, the Seahawks are back in it at Foxborough, trailing 17-7. Dave Craig goes up top for the former Colt, Ray Butler. He beats Vincy Glenn, the defensive back, on the play for the Patriots. And the Seahawks are within three at 17-14. Dick?
Well, a three-point game at Foxborough, and so it is here at Giants Stadium. Gives to Hector to the 32-yard line, a gain of four.
Let's go back in time just to that last touchdown play and watch Mark Duper. A little bend to the inside right there, and then the quick acceleration upfield. Jerry Holmes just no way to recover on that play as Duper takes it, drops into the end zone.
Second
speed. It kills. There's no question about it.
Look at the numbers on Duper. Set a Miami record with 217 yards against the Jets last year. And Miami needs only 80 more in the second half to tie that. Walker in motion. fullback Tony Page gets a rare call, and he's to the 34-yard line. It'll be third and 3.5. Atlanta, a couple of quick scores to take a lead at Dallas in the third period. Philadelphia's finally scored on a Cunningham pass to Jackson of 29 yards. And Tampa Bay apparently going to win its first game of the year at Detroit.
Detroit had played so well at home last year, having their troubles there this year.
Third down and short, and O'Brien going on top to Toon, and a flag this time against Langford. They became entangled again.
Now, wait a minute. Let's see what they're calling it down. Too much of a good thing for Langford.
Toon had him hung out to dry.
Defensive pass interference, number 44, first down.
At the 36-yard line, first down Jets.
What a great target Al Toon is. Just huge and long arms, about a 39-inch reach.
43-inch vertical jump.
And a 43-inch jump. I'll tell you, you can hang it out there and say, okay, I'll go get it.
Well, we saw him in his first start, and saw him was injured last year against Miami in the top 10. Cleaver in motion. O'Brien, lots of time. Underneath to Cleaver.
Ooh. Sometimes it's a good idea just to get to the ground. Cleaver, who always fights for that extra yard, in that particular situation ends up spinning backwards and backwards. Coming in motion on that play, and he just went up inside and hooked into an open area. O'Brien obviously looking downfield. Cleaver was about a third choice on that play. Finally got the ball into him.
Looked like a man trying to go the wrong way through one of those revolving doors.
He did. But he certainly, O'Brien again with a lot of time to pass. Both quarterbacks have not been hurried that much today.
Second and 5. Fake to Blyton. O'Brien in trouble. Eats it. Fumbles. And Miami has recovered. Number 99, George Little, comes up with the ball. No one had seen the fumble except for Little and the official, Pat Haggerty.
Just at a moment when you say they haven't hurried O'Brien, they get to him quickly.
T.J. Turner and Mark Brown. Brown subbing for the injured star Hugh Green.
Pat Haggerty right on top of the play. And he could see that that ball is being knocked loose. Look at him. He's not calling, not blowing the whistle. He's just watching there. And who is that? Is that Reggie McElroy, who's just standing there thinking the play is over. That ball loose in there. I'm sure he just thought it was a sack and it was all finished.
Oh, a break for the Dolphins, and they take over the Jets' 47-yard line. Each team has capitalized on the other's mistakes, and now it's Marino trying to put Miami in front with 8:22 left in the third quarter. He's going deep. Could be intercepted. No, he outthrew everyone, including number 28, Carl Howard.
Right on the sideline. A rather sloppy game in some critical areas today. Some big plays, but some very sloppy plays to turn the advantage back the other way.
And again, your point, Merlin, about O'Brien, this is really only his second full year playing in the NFL, hanging onto the ball. That sack count belongs to him as well, and in this case, hanging onto it so long, not only sack, but losing the ball.
Now, that's one of the things we talked to O'Brien about, or to Joe Walton about yesterday, is that you do take a risk when that quarterback is sacked, because sometimes the ball is knocked loose.
Receivers for Marino out of the shotgun. Instead, hands off to Nathan. Good block. 40. 30. And Tony Nathan, what a reliable veteran he is, to the 27 before Lester Lyles can capture him. 20-yard gain.
Very effective running play out of the shotgun. Little forward handoff right there. Marino just stepped up, hands it to Nathan. And Nathan, who goes through that line very quickly, they're all expecting pass on that play. Got everybody stretched out, and he took advantage of it.
He just took advantage of Gastineau's pass rush. He was charging hard, just bumped him to the outside, and ran inside him for 20.
They flip-flopped Gastineau to the open side, away from the tight end. I want to try and put a little extra squeeze on that quarterback.
He's on this side. Is Gastineau. Over the middle. Oh, Mark Clayton won't drop many of those. Carl Howard was the closest jet, but that had six written on it for Clayton. Reno says that's all right.
That's all right. Sure he does, too. People ask why Marino's numbers were down last year after such a spectacular season in 84.
Why were they down?
Well, one very good reason. Clayton was hurt part of the year. Duper hurt most of the year. You take those two guys away from any quarterback, and he's going to have trouble.
Year before, 61%. 64%, 48 touchdowns, 5,000 yards.
I don't think we're ever going to see those numbers again. I really don't.
Unless it happens today. Second and 10. That one intended for Nat Moore. And there's a case where Marino had to hurry the pass so Moore didn't have a chance to turn and look.
Well, and that's the kind of situation where the styles of these two quarterbacks are so dramatically different. Marino will not allow you to sack him if he has any chance to get that ball away and just throw it away. O'Brien, on the other hand, has been trained to eat that football, and that's the way he does it.
And in that case, had Marino had another half second, obviously Moore was open, but he had to unload.
I'll tell you one thing. Neither of these quarterbacks lack courage. They'll stand in there and take as much time as they can get to throw the football.
Trying to take advantage of O'Brien's fumble. Big play, third and 10 at the 27. On top for Duper. Incomplete against Davlin Mullen. So the Jets defense able to stop Marino's passing game. And here comes Fouad Reves to try a field goal. He is 1-for-2 on this young season.
Mullen chewed up rather badly last week in that New England game. He's had 10 days to think about it. I'm sure pleased that ball did not end up in the hands of Mark Duper.
It'll be a 45-yard attempt out of Don Strock's hold. And this would tie it up. Midpoint of the third quarter. We have a new game. It's even at 31 with 7 minutes and 12 seconds left in the third quarter. 45-yard field goal by Reves, and we start anew at Giants Stadium. You just joined us. That is not a typographical error. 31 each, and we have 7 minutes 12 seconds left in the third quarter. Dolphins with 10 points here in the third period. Move back into a tie. There's Bobby Humphrey anticipating Fouad Reves's kickoff. Short. Humphrey at the 11. Body really flying. And Humphreys as well, as 3 flags go down.
Well, watch for Nate Thompson, number 24, go down there just like a guided missile.
And the push in the back
right here
against the Jets means that New York will start around its own 10-yard line.
That Renee Thompson, number 24, is a real flyer. Look at him right in the bottom of your screen. Now watch him as he accelerates. Look at the way he just throws his body in there, blazes past a couple of blockers. Watch him right here, just dives in there. And now that's genuine kamikaze performance.
Somehow I just can't see you doing that, Merlin.
Well, when I was a rookie, I didn't run quite that fast, though.
You would have tripped over your 5-minute cap at you. You were too intelligent to do that. Come on. O'Brien to the sidelines to Walker, and of course that play should work the way that Walker has gone deep. They have to give him some room, and that's an 8-yard game. Buffalo, Greg Bell has scored to give the Bills a 2-touchdown lead. Atlanta scored on a fumble recovery touchdown and an interception touchdown to take the lead of Dallas. Denver apparently will make it 3-0. New England now ahead again by 10. Rams 21-7. It's been that way for a long time. Minnesota and Tampa Bay have healthy leads. It's a high-scoring day. This third week of the NFL
like the
season.
First week was very high scoring. Second week the defenses were there again.
And second and two. Little inside handoff to Dennis Blygen. And Miami says they have it. They do. Jeff Offerdahl in the midst of the celebration. As Blygen, just an innocent little play up the middle to pick up the first down. And the last two possessions have led to Miami fumble recoveries. Mark Brown.
Last one up. He and Jackie Shipp. George Little. Walton doesn't know what to think here. A real stack up. Baumhauer 73, Shipp number 50. Let's see if we can see what happens. That ball was already loose as they got to that point. And the scrambling Dolphin. There's the ball popping loose. Rolled in underneath. Looked like Mark Brown may have gotten down there in time to scoop it up.
Now the turnovers now even three aside. The game even at 31. Miami from the Jets 30-yard line.
Ooh.
Woody Bennett pulled out of bounds inside the 20-yard line.
Woody had a little trouble finding the handle on that one. Finally able to corral it. By that time, almost out of bounds. Boy, mistakes can turn it around so quickly. The turnovers in a game, the fumbles, the sacks. There you see the turnovers. The first half, a big edge for the Jets as the Dolphins were turning it loose. But here, it's been two costly errors. The Dolphins quick to capitalize on the first. And about to capitalize unless something goes wrong on the second.
Marino now with 305 yards passing. Second and two. And Nathan, nothing there.
Joe Klecko.
Oh, yes, he was there.
Klecko, we have not heard as much from Klecko as you did in the first 2 weeks of this season. But again, it's good to remind you that Klecko is playing against a man that many consider to be the finest center in the league. And in that kind of battle, there are going to be more standoffs than out-and-out victories.
Dwight Stevenson, he says the thing, Klecko and all the rest, Howie Long, to say about Stevenson. Everyone else double teams us, but Stevenson takes us on one on.
Well, he's had help today. He's had a lot of help on Klecko today.
On the shotgun on third and four. Wide open Duker. And he's to the 2 yard line against Jerry Holmes. Duker very close to his third touchdown of the game.
Marino loves that man-to-man coverage. Blitz coming, as you saw Lester Lyle coming. That means that they're in man-to-man coverage on those wide receivers. Duper just broke it inside with a slant. Jerry Holmes, although he was there, couldn't do anything but drag him down.
Seven catches, 154 yards for Duper. He leaves the game as they go with the two tight ends and the three backs. Up the middle. Short of the goal line. Ron Davenport stopped by Charles Jackson and company. I want to welcome those of you who have been watching in the Washington, D.C. and Dallas areas. We have a real scramble here at Giants Stadium in East Rutherford, New Jersey. Dick Enberg with Merlin Olsen. It's tied at 31. The Dolphins and Jets with 4:58 left in the third quarter. You see Lance Mell, valuable property linebacker of the Jets, injured on the last play. For those of you just joining us, Hugh Green, the all-pro linebacker of the Miami Dolphins, left the game on a stretcher in the first half with a knee injury. And they will x-ray that again when the Dolphins arrive home in Miami. It did not appear that, he won't play in this game, and he may not play for some time.
Mel, who's been playing hurt with ankle problems, on the ground and obviously in pain. Right-hand side of your screen, look for number 56. You see him right there, and it looks like maybe somebody stepped down on that leg. You see him grabbing his right knee or ankle.
And we have a timeout with 4:58 left in the third period. Examining the ankle of Lance Mell in the blue shirt, Dr. James Nicholas. We'll talk more about him later. They're going to honor him next week here in New York. It's second and goal at the one as Miami just 3 feet away from the lead. Nathan says he's in. No signal yet. They're going to mark it just shy of the goal line.
Good job by the Jets defense. An extra defensive lineman in on the play as they were able to
stymie the drive. Watch the initial surge, and you can see that the Jets are able to stop the penetration of the line and able to stack enough bodies in there to keep Nathan away from that goal
line. Actually, it was Davenport, Merlin. Nathan out front blocking. Looked as if he had the ball. It was Davenport. Stop. Third and goal. Shula and the Dolphins pass for a touchdown from the one-yard line in the first half. And they're going to throw again. Touchdown. The fifth touchdown pass of the game. This one goes to Bruce Hardy. Duper with two. Hardy has one. Johnson has one. And James Pruitt, the rookie, has one. So Marino has tied his own high with the Dolphins with five touchdown passes. Two fumbles recovered by the Dolphins here in the third quarter have led to touchdowns and plus a field goal. And with 4:12 left in the period, it's 37-31 Miami. Quad Reves adds the extra point. The Jets scored 28 points, a New York record in the second period, and now 17 unanswered by Miami in the third. Fifth touchdown pass of the game. He is now two away from the NFL record. Sid Luckman, Adrian Burke, George Blanda, Y.A. Tittle, and Joe Kapp all threw for five and for seven touchdowns in a single NFL game. Bob Greasy, as you saw, the Miami record holder with six. Plenty of time. 4:12 left in the third period. Reves. It's a deep to Harper, and he'll not take it out.
Let's go quickly back and look at that replay. You saw Lance Mell go out of the game. And right here is Troy Benson, the linebacker that went into his place. Now watch him as he is faked into the line. The other man to watch is right over here, Bruce Hardy, who's simply going to go down and clear out. Let's turn it loose. Now watch Benson, who believes it's a run. He comes right up inside, and the ball goes over his head. Nobody there. What a nice play. And again, taking advantage of what happens on the field. The injury puts a new man in there who's not used to reacting. Marino and the Dolphins beat him instantly.
O'Brien goes to work. To the sidelines to Cleaver, and he's been a busy target throughout the course of this game. And Cleaver has a first down out at the 35. 15 more yards. Buffalo with a two-touchdown lead. At Dallas back to lead by one, and a crazy one at Irving. Denver apparently will go 3-0. New England's lead cut to 3 by Seattle. Rams and Indianapolis stuck on 21-7 for three quarters. Minnesota and Tampa Bay on their way to a win.
Nobody's stuck on any number here.
No. Just don't blink an eye. Johnny Hector. And a little running back from Texas A&M. And a flag goes down. Picks up five. And we'll check the penalty call.
I think we've got a holding call. Good play by Mark Brown, who's been in there for the injured Hugh Green. Oh. Face mask. You see a good pursuit angle taken by Mark Brown here, who'll come all the way from behind to get a shot right there. Yeah, well, I think maybe.
Face mask.
Sure couldn't see the face mask.
Down stays the same. First down.
Well, there was no, obviously not a face mask on the. I don't know, Dick, where that one took place.
I didn't see it.
And it's going to be second down and one, or two.
Wide open, Al Toon. He has a first down at the Miami 47. William Jetson did the play defensively, 14 yards for. Now play a sweet tune. He's such a graceful looking athlete at 6'4 and 205 from Wisconsin. Studied ballet, wants to be a model. He says, I want to be in GQ or one of those magazines. On first down. On top to Toon. Incomplete.
Oh, talk about being shadowed by William Judson. Breathing down his neck the whole way. Kachun had him turned around, but couldn't come up with the ball.
Kachun is man-to-man coverage here by Judson, who is running well with him. Kachun loses the ball, and when you have to twist all the way around like that, I think that's about as tough a catch as you can find because you've got to relocate the ball.
That's a play that Duper and Marino work so well with. Duper always fades, looks for the ball to the sidelines. Kachun thought it was there, but it was not. O'Brien with a couple of touchdown passes and 241 yards. He's had a good day and also fumbled once and one interception. Draw play. Hector hit by Offerdahl. At the 44-yard line, Betters was there as well.
George Little. We saw Offerdahl going for that football. Hector clamping down on it. Made more than their share of mistakes today. They certainly don't want to make another one. Miami quickly capitalizing on those two turnovers to move ahead in this ball game. The Jets looking for seven to tie it up again.
Walker to the right. He has two touchdown catches, 65 and 50 yards. O'Brien. It's a great catch by Cleaver. Or Townsell it is. JoJo Townsell. A wobbly pass. Toughest of all, having to reach below your knees to catch it in traffic. And Townsell's first grab is a big first down reception.
It's a maturing process. O'Brien waits until the last second, gets that ball out. It just floats in there. And Townsell, with his hands on the ground, actually, before that ball arrived, very athletic grab. Coaches told me before the game that they expected Townsell to be doing well in there today. They've been impressed with the way he's practiced.
15 yards for Joseph.
They're taking a look at it. I think they buzzed that one to see if that was indeed a catch. A question about whether or not it was a catch, and I think they have looked at it or at least examined it with the replay. And now remember, they can't or won't reverse it unless there is very good irrefutable proof.
This is the same angle, not a great one, that they looked at. I don't know if that's irrefutable evidence, and that's part of the system that is bothering me, that there's a play in the Rams and 49ers last week, and then a call was made that somehow to me, in my eye, didn't seem to be evidence that was total. From that angle, and from what you have seen, they have ruled that an incomplete pass.
Well, like it or not, it is called that way. They will move the sticks back. It's going to be
instead of first down, it's fourth down. That's a big reversal.
That is a big turnaround. Townsell, did Townsell argue? I didn't get a chance to see. Maybe it was late. He's on the sideline. There's no question the ball was very close to the ground, but not an easy one for me to call from this angle.
Dave Jennings in the apparent punt situation now, and floating back is James Pruitt. Nat Moore will take Pruitt's spot. The veteran Moore down deep toward that Miami goal line. Don Shula wants to use the sure-handed veteran. Boy, that is a big call. Instead of first down and a continuing drive, it's called back.
He's blocked a kick in each of the last 2 years against the Jets. They're concerned about him. He was in there hassling Jennings as he kicked that one away.
See the combination passing, running. It's been Dolphins through the air. The Jets have been able to run more effectively, but not an alarming total there for Don Shula's defense. Most of those yards by Johnny Hector, subbing for the injured Freeman McNeil. McNeil will be out for probably at least four or five more weeks. Lance Mel has returned to the Jets lineup, the linebacker.
When you have ankle problems, and Mel is going to suffer with them, I'm afraid, throughout the year, he certainly has not been able to get them healthy in the early part of the season here. Very often you get them twisted and the pain is
frightening. You don't know whether how badly they're hurt. Get off the sideline and say, it's all right, put me back in there. And he's back.
Marino to the air again. Deep down the middle for Johnson. Incomplete. And Johnson was open at the 40, covered by Lester Lyles. But in traffic, could not come down with it.
Dan Marino is not afraid to throw that football to receivers that are covered. He's done it repeatedly throughout his career. He did it on that particular play.
Well, don't you, Merlin, see often that Marino, with that quick release and those timing moves, that so often the defensive players have their back to him anyway, don't know when he has thrown.
No question about that. If you look at some of Marino's career stats, his only loss coming in last year's game, a game in which the Jets really dominated them on the line of scrimmage, defensively and offensively.
That's the night they retired Joe Namath's number. Remember, 23-7 they beat them.
Very emotional game.
Marino signaling to his double wide receiver, Seth.
He's called an audible.
He got it away with 1 second left on the 30-second clock. Duper, and their flag is down. Now, this is going to be an interesting call. They both were pushing. Duper first, and then was pushed back by the Jet. We'll see how they rule it.
I'm going to go back. Offensive what? Offensive. 85. Offensive pass interference.
There you go.
Offensive pass interference. Number 85.
So it goes against Duper.
So the Dolphins have benefited from a call just before this that took a first down away from the Jets. On this particular occasion, it's offensive interference on Duper. Let's watch Duper now. Jerry Holmes, man-to-man, number 47. He gets a late shove there. And let's watch Duper pushing his head back right there. You saw him, and then a second push.
And Holmes was pushing.
Well, I'll tell you, there's a lot of contact on that play.
And it looked as if Holmes had contact beyond the 5 yards as well. So that was a real mess. But it goes against Shula and the Dolphins. And he is burning the back ear of the side judge who is immediately in front of him. Ball at the 5-yard line. Second down, a long 15. Interestingly, Marino under center in this situation. From his end zone, he throws it away. There was no one there. And Gastineau was on top of Marino.
And again, Marino's pointing to Gastineau and say, hey, who's supposed to block this guy? Gastineau in very quickly. You'll see him coming from your left-hand side here. Nobody to pick him up. Lance Mell out there solo to F. He's the one that was singled up. Nobody there. Mell got there first, and Gastineau from the right-hand side. So there were two bodies on him. But nobody picked up the blitzing linebacker, and Marino had to throw it away.
1 minute, 29 seconds remaining in the third quarter. Some of the Jets fans on their feet down at this end as Marino stares at third and long. And out of it he comes, the Mark Clayton at the 34-yard line. And Marino has a big first down throw, 28 yards.
Marty Lyons ended up on top of Marino on that play, but no flags.
New England back in front by 10. Seattle creeps to 3, and then the Patriots get another touchdown. Here it's 38-31. Miami with 17 points here in the third quarter to overcome a 31-21 lead enjoyed by the Jets at the intermission. Clayton now wearing eye protectors. He has 108 yards and 5 catches. Duper, 7 catches, over 150 yards.
Marino still proving that he can take that scalpel to defenses, and especially those that are already carved up with injury.
Even there where they knew he was going to pass. Nathan. And a flag down as Nathan struggles across the 35-yard line.
Ronnie Lee, number 72, I think getting a late shove using his hands on Klecko.
Holding 61, hooked him and grabbed him.
Roy Foster.
take him back?
Hooked him and grabbed him.
He's asking the defensive captain, do you want me to take the penalty, take him back?
Hey, what do you want to do?
Well, we get a little insight into responsibilities and the emotion of the officials.
I don't think Pat knows that his mic is open. Maybe just as well we turn it off for him. Roy Foster guilty of the hold. Final seconds of the third period. Duper and Pruitt to the right. In fact, Clayton and Pruitt to the right. Duper and Moore to the left.
Four wides and a single back.
And Nathan. That play worked in the first half. Ooh, the umpire almost got it as Nathan goes out to the 34-yard line. Ben Rudolph and Lance Mel with a tackle close to 10 yards in the game.
The philosophy there being you can spread those defensive backs far enough to give that runner time to come up the middle.
End of the third quarter. It's Miami 38, the Jets 31. We'll be right back after these messages from your local station. Welcome back to Giants Stadium. Dick Enberg with Merlin Olsen. A scoring fest on this late September afternoon. It's 38-31 Miami. Winner goes to 2-1. The loser drops to 1-2.
And drops two games behind an apparently undefeated New England Patriot team.
Patriots lead in the fourth quarter by 10 against Seattle at home. Big play. Second down and 10. Miami at the 34. As we open the fourth period after the Dolphins scored 17 unanswered points in the third to take the lead. Over the middle, and it's another completion to Clayton at the 45-yard line of the Jets. 21 more yards. Humphrey made the tackle. Boy, the combination of the two marks, Clayton and Duper. Duper with seven catches and 154 yards. Clayton now six catches and 128.
128 or 129. And again, Marino not afraid to throw it right in there into the coverage. Dares those defenders to get it. But again, and I think it's just confidence in his receivers, Dick.
And again, Humphrey not really able to get a good look at the ball. He's so busy trying to entangle himself with the receiver. Marino with five touchdowns in the game. Is this one a catch? At the 35-yard line, no. They say it is not. A late call. Duper did not get that one.
The typical of the kind of plays that Marino has been running all day long, the timing pattern to the outside. Watch Duper. He's going to drive his man off with his speed, and then when he gets the defensive man to turn, right in there, he spins back to the sideline. The ball has already been thrown. Is it a catch? Well, I don't think you're going to see from this angle.
That is an even futile.
No,
that's irrefutable.
The officials said no, and it goes to second and 10.
Ball at the 45 of the Jets, 38-31 Miami. First minute of the fourth period.
Gloves for those two guys down there. Little shoulder move there. Little throwback by Duper. Ball out of range, and that may not have been called because it was not a catchable ball.
10 minutes. Boy, how quickly it goes by. What a nice service that is, that any 10 minutes you know exactly what the scores are at all the other NFL games. Down to a 7-point lead for New England in the fourth. And Detroit with a late rally, down by only four against the Buccaneers. Third and 10.
Big play.
Deep to Clayton, too deep. Said, oh, if I just waited a split
second longer, I had Clayton breaking free. So Reggie Roby, a rare experience, at least in the second half. Roby in to punt for the first time in this half. Kurt Sohn, who had an excellent punt return that led to the first score of the game, a field goal. He had a 27-yard punt return as deep for the Jets. Jets will start at the 20-yard line when we return to Giant Stadium, where the score reads Miami 38, Jets 31.
Here's the disputed play of a moment ago. We show it to you here to emphasize what the rule is supposed to be. The replay official should only overrule if his view is conclusive that a mistake has been made. And we're not saying they got it wrong, but is this conclusive that JoJo Townsell trapped it? Looks like it could go either way, and in that case, they're supposed to let the call stand. Food for thought, Dick and Merlin.
Now that's going to be a meal for the 1986 season. That's just food for thought. It continues to be controversial at best, the instant replay. Meanwhile, the Jets, trailing by a touchdown, have it at their own 20. Hector punching out to the 26-yard line, where it'll be second and four. Well, the other angle that we had on the Townsell catch was from the end zone, and here is that. Is this inconclusive or conclusive evidence?
The significance, obviously, of that play was that that was a first down just outside of the 30-yard line. They ended up, the Jets ended up having to punt as a result of that reversal of the call.
Second down and four. Hector, the call again, trying to get outside. Well, he's done some nice running. First down at the 31. Meanwhile, Mark Duper, the sensational wide receiver of the Dolphins, applying ice on his forehead or his right eye.
Reminiscent of the head injury to Harry Hamilton here last week. A blow, and no one seems to really know what happened to him. He ended up stacked up on the ground, split his head wide open. You see them looking earlier at Mark Duper's right eye and then applying ice. But Hamilton ended up with a 6-inch cut, 27 stitches. Can't put the helmet on yet, and will be out, certainly out this game and maybe even next week.
The defensive back of the Jets, O'Brien, play action and going deep, has a man.
William Judson all the way around on that play. Again, the play action, and that works when you've got the running game going. You see it right here. Judson had his back to the ball as Toon cut inside. One thing that scares you, look how he's carrying that football. I'm sure that Bob Brzezinski had his eye on that football. Watch it here. He's lucky he saw Brzezinski and was able to pull it in, or that ball may have been bouncing out of there.
And it's just like walking out on the street in front of a truck. Legend, who fumbled in the third quarter and fumbles again, but goes out of bounds, Jets possession. We hear now that the injury to Duper, a finger in the eye, and we do not know whether he will return.
This field position almost equal to what the Jets would have had at the other end of the field. See if they're able to get things together. They're only seven down, 11:42 in the fourth quarter, in a game that has seen enough points to make all of us wonder about defensive football.
4 points scored in this game than the two games they played combined last year. Hector, nothing there. That's going to be third down and seven. Jackie Shipp, number 50, led the charge. Shipp from Oklahoma. Oh, what a team the Sooners seem to have this year. Again.
On that play, defense finally rising to the occasion here. Third down,
79 yards for Johnny Hector, subbing for the injured Freeman McNeil. He's done a solid job.
That's about what he's averaged in the six games, close to 100 yards per game. So he has been a very effective replacement for Freeman McNeil.
Dolphins playing pass. They rush four men. O'Brien doesn't disappoint. Kurt Sohn, first down, 18.
corner trying to cover Stone. That ball thrown a little bit high, but Stone is a battler, and he went up and pulled it down.
Well, if they had a campaign for overachievers, Stone might be the poster boy.
Boy, I'll tell you, watch him go up in the air here. Full extension, knows he's going to take the hit on the way down. Langford going for that football, but it's a first and 10.
Inside the 18, call it the 17. Plenty of time left. Miami by a touchdown, 38-31. Tune in motion. O'Brien throws it away. Tune was well covered. Langford and Bud Brown have him. Ken O'Brien. He was the 24th pick in the first round in 1983. That was that sensational quarterback year. Boy, what talent. First it was Elway, then Tony Eason, then Todd Blackledge, then O'Brien, then Jim Kelly. Now with Buffalo and finally Dan Marino.
Well, they've had reunions along the way with Kelly 2 weeks ago, with Eason last week, and this week with Marino. They have yet to meet Elway. They'll see him down the road, and then repeats of the three aforementioned quarterbacks. So they're going to have a lot of reunions of that class this year.
Throws to Tony Page. Fullback gets to the 10-yard line. Now they're knocking at the 11. 6-yard gain. It'll be third and four when we return. First, this update.
Dick, you and Merlin have the game of the day there at the Meadowlands, but this might be second best. At Foxborough, another blocked punt by the Seahawks. Patrick Hunter blocks the Rich Camarillo kick. Paul Moyer covers it in the end zone, and the game is tied with 1:54 left, 31 apiece.
A 31 all there. The Jets are 11 yards away from making this one 38 all. And boy, how Chuck Knox is special teams
and defense, and they've done it up there today. We've seen a lot of big plays on special teams here today as well.
Both quarterbacks over 300 yards passing. O'Brien on third and four, and he'll throw out of the backfield. Hector, does he have enough for a first down?
No, he's short.
He's to the 8-yard line. That will be very close, but not enough.
Ow.
And O'Brien is slow getting up. He was hit just as he delivered the ball.
Third and less than a yard to go. Fourth and less than a yard to go. And there goes Griggs. That's the third tight end into the game. Tony Page, the big short yardage back. He usually gets the call in this kind of situation.
Shula, meanwhile, takes out four of the pass defensive types and puts in more beef.
You saw Bobby Hammond, the coach with his hands raised in the air. He's signaling in the formation so they know who's supposed to come out.
This could be the game. Was hit at the line of scrimmage and was able to fight forward about a half yard. Was it enough?
I believe he's got it, Dick. That second effort has its payoffs, and you saw Page, who was so physically strong, he was able to take that first shot, keep his legs moving, and drive that pile ahead.
Number 90, Merlin, Andy Hindle from North Carolina State, 2 years in the USFL, made that hit. But Page, with the power, 225 pounds, able to fall forward. And now the official measurement.
They're going to trot it in from the sideline. There's the signal by Bobby Hammond. And what he's saying is, this is the formation call. If you're supposed to be in there, stay there. If not, get the heck out of there.
Well, the crowd quiets as they wait for them to stretch out the chains. Credit Woody Page with that. He just made it, and it took that little lurch forward for the Jets to get it first and goal at the 7. Tony Page, what a job. First final, Tampa Bay. It's first win of the year, 24-20. We have 9 minutes left here at Giant Stadium. Jets trying to tie it. Blyton with blockers behind Sweeney. He has a touchdown. Dennis Blyton's first touchdown of the year. Did he have an escort? Number 53, Jim Sweeney.
And they're running at a position usually occupied by Hugh Green.
Green, of course, out of the ballgame since an injury in the second quarter. We'll get a look at that right after this kick.
Pat Leahy ties it up. 80 yards in 11 plays.
Watch the block by Cleaver coming in on the top. 89 right there. Sweeney, 53, pulls out and blocks on Judson. And Blygen just pulls away into the end zone.
Blygen, who went to a lower Manhattan high school that didn't have a football team. We have an unofficial report down on the field that has now been denied. These two teams are not disguised as the San Diego Chargers. These are the real folks, Miami and the Jets, 38 all. Kind of game you expect when you see the Chargers play. Pat Leahy to kick it off, 8:42 left. Might be whoever has the ball last. Hampton. Is that Joe Carter? And he takes a lick from Griggs and then is pushed back inside the 15. Billy Griggs had got there first. A reminder, our viewers, we'll have the Budweiser Most Valuable Player for today's game at the conclusion. Well, we could have a tough battle.
A lot of explosive plays. There are also some candidates for worst player of the day. I'm glad we don't have to choose that one, Dick. Hugh Green on the sideline. You see that leg bandaged and a big ice pack on that right kneecap.
Boy, that's like saying your expensive car with a big dent in it. That's a valuable property. Hugh Green. Marino. Flag down. Clifton gets Hampton. Game now well over 3 hours old, and we have 8:25 left. The call is against the Jets. Miami will take the play, and Marino chalks up another 10 yards plus on his passing count. Marino is approaching the 400-yard mark. Joe Costanz, our statistician, working on those numbers, and he's using both hands. He's writing with the right and the left today. First down at the 29.
You need a computer.
He's 17 yards shy of 400. He may get it on this play. Close. Flag down as Holmes makes the tackle on Clayton at the 41. Matt Haggerty's been busy.
Offensive pass interference, number 87.
It is against Dan Johnson, the tight end.
I think what we're seeing there is a pick being called against the Dolphins, clearing the way for Clayton. Third down conversions on the day. The Dolphins are 6 of 11. The Jets 5 of 13. So both teams below 50%. Maybe we can see that play. Well, just the end of it. But you can see Dan Johnson standing just at the top of the play, and there were two defenders there. He'd obviously bumped into them. He's not allowed to do that while the ball was in the air.
Now Marino, first down in the hole. He approached the midpoint of this fourth quarter. Screen to Hampton. Oh, what a hit. Credit Matt Munger, the second-year linebacker from Oklahoma State. He's another of those overachievers. Went to college as a walk-on running back, made a linebacker, played on the scout team as a running back 2 years at Oklahoma State. He had a college quarterback named Rusty Hildred out there with the Raiders. Marino with 385 yards passing, O'Brien with 306. 5 TDs to 2, Marino over O'Brien.
Of course, the Jets have counted on their ground attack for a lot of their success today. Marino almost entirely up on top.
Second. Ooh. Key, Marino lucky to find the handle. Flag down. And official, number 82. What a catch.
92.
Jim Poole. He was on his way. Don't stop now, Jim.
I think there was a whistle blown before that play.
He heard the whistle and just wanted to stop it, but this play will go into the, I guarantee you, this goes into the booper file.
8 seconds back on the clock. 8 seconds.
Well, Jim, the only thing, though, he didn't shift the ball to the right arm so they could protect it against the on-rushing.
What happens if he scores? Here it is. Stepping up. He's waving his arms. The play is over.
Listen to the crowd. They have just seen the replay that you have watched. Come on, Jim. Crack a smile.
Well, that's not a smiling violation for Marino and the Dolphins as that marches them back another 5. Second, about 22, 23 yards to go.
In a Mardi Gras atmosphere here at Giants Stadium, 38-38. It has been a football celebration of sorts.
And they're putting a sign up that says defense, defense, defense. Where are they going to find one?
I'm not sure they could even spell it.
There it is, up on the Giants scoreboard at each end of this magnificent stadium, modeled after the same structure at Arrowhead in Kansas City.
No question it's a great stadium, Vic, but if you look at all this plastic and artificial turf, I'm not sure this is a football stadium.
Out of 76,000, at least that many tickets sold, over 76,000, and most of them highly entertained. Meanwhile, we want to keep an eye on that game up at Foxborough, tied at the last report. With Dallas and Atlanta, 1-point game there. Seattle has gone in front of New England, 38-31 on a 67-yard pass from Craig to Butler. So Seattle down by 10, suddenly leading by 7 with a minute 13 left.
You scooped the 10-minute ticker.
I do not know why they are not playing. Second and 23, no timeout was called. Oh, the net at the end of the stadium beyond the upright fell down, but why that's significant enough to stop now, I don't know.
Nobody's kicking the ball at this moment.
So they lose a ball. Shula, Don Shula, is saying, let's go ahead with it.
Maybe Pat Haggerty will tell us what's going on. Started once more. 30-second clock is ticking.
Pruitt, Clayton to the left. Duper with Moore in the backfield, and he'll probably go right. Moore's lined up at the right halfback position. They've got Marino at the 9-yard line. Gastineau, Lyons, and Klecko. The second sack for the Jets. The other came when Marino tripped going back to pass, so this is the first sack resulting from a legitimate rush.
The Jets only had 3 sacks coming into this game. That's 5 on the season. You see the speed on the outside, and it's Bob Crable, number 50, coming in on Marino, and then some powerful play inside by Klecko. The combination is good. And look at Lyons. He's celebrating in there with a couple of whacks to Klecko's helmet.
Third and a bunch. 29. Oh, my. It's Duper again. Oh, Clayton at the 48-yard line. Third and 29, and Marino uncorks a beautiful rainbow to Clayton.
Let's just watch Clayton right here. Just a little fade and up the field, and it's a timing pattern. It's a one-on-one coverage, but watch him as he bursts out of that backfield. Johnny Lynn trying to cover him. That ball's already in the air, and it's just a one-on-one battle. Clayton wins it. Perfect over-the-shoulder pass by Dan Marino.
First down at the 49 of the Jets. Mark Clayton and Mark Duper chewing up that injury-riddled deep defense of the Jets. 171 yards now for Clayton on seven catches. On the ground, and that's something they've not been able to do, Hampton wrestled back by Marty Lyons.
You might ask, why does Marino and why do the Dolphins throw so many more times than they run in this game? And there are two reasons. Their strength is in the passing game to begin with. But also the Jets continue to stack a lot of people, often eight men, sometimes even more up tight to that line. And the Dolphins feel that they've got to challenge that kind of defense. There's Carson, whose philosophy is to play pressure defense. It's pretty tough when you're as wounded in the secondary as he is, but still look at them. They've got eight people up tight and two more that are right up next to the line of scrimmage.
Marino fires to Johnson. Incomplete. Almost deflected back to Carl Howard of the Jets. Marino was a fine baseball player in high school. In fact, was drafted as a third baseman. Boy, he just looked like a third baseman going deep behind the bag and bracing to make the long throw to first. 400 yards passing. Fouts with six. Marino with five. The Hall of Famer Sonny Jurgensen with five. But Marino has his five in 3 years.
Just and a matter of time, isn't it?
Closing in on his sixth today. Well, he's got it.
That's right. He's got it. That's right. He was four. He had four coming into today.
4 minutes, 28 seconds left. 38-38 tie. Third and 10. Clayton unable to come down with the ball as he was hit just as it arrived. Humphrey, Howard, both were there.
Very smart play by Humphrey as that ball was bounced into the air. He reached up and took Clayton's arms right out of the air. You've got to try and strip that ball away, especially from receivers who will take it in traffic. You see him there? You see Humphrey go up and just jerk those arms down. The receiver himself, he knows that's one way to keep the man from catching it.
Reggie Roby the punt. Kurt Sohn back at the 10. On fourth and 10. What a game. 7-3 favor of the Dolphins into the first period. At the half, 31-21 Jets. Almost blocked. Fair catch for Sohn and a tough fair catch at the 17-yard line. At the end of three, 38-31 Miami, and it's currently tied at 38 with 4:17 left. Here at Giant Stadium, it's tied at 38, and as we were leaving, I thought I detected a chortle, a little laugh out of your presence. Now, what was that all about? 38, just because of all the scoring?
I got to tell you, as a defensive player, I know how painful it's going to be. Fumble.
Is it called a completed pass? That's the key here. It is Miami's ball. Now the question, did Walker have possession? And this will probably send that vibrating message to the umpire that says, wait, let's look at the replay.
What replay? We'll have one here momentarily for you. The officials have indeed signaled completion and fumble.
Now here, coaches have become alert enough that Joe Walton is going to certainly wait for this to happen. Here is the replay. Walker 1 foot. And he came down with both feet. That's a legal
catch. Awfully close, though, Dick. The officials are asking for that one to be...
That's a tough call.
If the play is run, it stands.
Look at Julie. He says, get up to the line of scrimmage.
Yeah,
and here they are. In field goal range already at the 27. Marino looking for more underneath to Hardy. And the tight end is close to the 17, and down goes the flag.
Kyle Clifton, number 59, going to be ticketed for a late hit out of bounds on Bruce Hardy.
And Klecko is injured. Joe Klecko.
As you see those people out there.
Defense. What?
Klecko's knee is up in the air as you see. Dr. Nichols out there, and oh boy.
Kyle Clifton ticketed for unnecessary roughness. It'll take the ball down inside the 10-yard line. And there's Joe Klecko, the all-pro nose tackle.
Klecko, the heart of that Jets defense.
Bringing up today, Buffalo, a final, has defeated St. Louis, 17-10. 35-34 Dallas in the fourth. Finals. Denver wins. They're 3-0. Seattle with a great come from behind at Foxborough. They're unbeaten, and New England goes to 2-1. That's good news for both Miami and the Jets. Rams win again. They're 3-0. Minnesota with an impressive win over Pittsburgh, and Tampa Bay with its first win of the year. They just announced the Seattle victory at New England. That brought a cheer.
Left knee for Joe Klecko, and maybe we can go back and see what happened on that last play. All we have is Klecko responding after the play, but you see him grabbing that left knee, and Klecko has had several serious knee injuries over the years.
And isn't it ironic that Hugh Green, the great linebacker of the Dolphins, now on the sidelines, has knee heavily taped, apparently a serious bruise or dislocated knee, and now it's Klecko holding the knee.
Klecko moving pretty well. Well, you never know. I say he's tough. He might walk off of there with a knee that's in a shambles. We'll have to wait for a report.
You know, Merlin, having played on the artificial surface, that there just isn't much pad underneath, and when you all that weight are jammed into the ground, as Hugh Green, he can certainly empathize.
There's no question in my mind that the turf shortens the life of the player. It simply does not give those injured knees and those parts of the body that take such a beating a chance to recover. And it used to take our players, and particularly those with knee problems, at least two or three extra days to recover from playing on artificial turf.
Right back to the action. With 3:45 left, Marino has a first and goal at the 8 after the penalty. Woody Bennett with a good hole is to the 4. Tom Baldwin, Kyle Clifton, and others.
You see them going right up the middle, knowing that Tom Baldwin is in to replace Klecko. They go right up the gut.
They're already well into the first period of some of the later games. Raiders early lead against the Giants, and San Diego leading Washington in the first. Kansas City over Houston by a field goal, and the 49ers lead New Orleans by 3. Here it's 38-all, 3:07, 3:06 left, second and goal. Marino is thrown for 2 1-yard touchdowns in this game, and he's got another score. That is the 6th touchdown pass of the game. Mark Clayton finally gets his.
Marino into the end zone to high five with Clayton. The Jets fumbling the ball away. Miami right back in a short burst to put it in the end zone.
Well, that's been the story of the second half for Miami. They've recovered 3 Jet fumbles, and those 3 fumbles have led to 17 points. Wad Reves has the extra point. Now it will be up to the Jets offense. They have plenty of time. All 3 of their timeouts remain, and 2 minutes 56 seconds left with Miami in front, 45-38. Mark Clayton's 8th catch of the game, 174 yards.
Quick slant inside, and Marino falling away, threads that ball between Jet defenders, puts it out in front of Clayton. Oh, I tell you, it's hard to look at that, just a slant inside.
Pretty well covered, wasn't it?
Yes, it was. Carl Howard all over Clayton. One more time. You look at it here. Howard is as close as he can be, but that ball is perfectly thrown. Clayton's body is between Howard and the ball. All he can do is try and strip it away.
Clayton, who set an NFL record with 18 touchdown catches in 84, has his 3rd of this season. Boy, the combination of Duper and Clayton. 6 touchdown passes from Reno to tie Bob Greasy's Miami club record. Duper has 7 catches, 2 touchdowns, 154 yards. Clayton, 8 catches, 1 touchdown, 174 yards. Total them up, 15 catches, 328 yards, 3 touchdowns from Duper and Clayton. Reves hits this one well. Boy, he's kicked well all day, 5 yards into the end zone. JoJo Townsell will take the touchback at the 20. And the Jets have 2:50 to try to force an overtime.
And it wouldn't surprise me. It's been that kind of day, hasn't it? It has been that kind of day.
reminiscent in a way of the game down in Miami when Ken O'Brien took his team 80 yards in the final minutes of the game for a touchdown, only to watch Marino come back to hit the play with Duper, a long bomb to win it for Miami in the final seconds of the game.
That's right. He hit Cleveland. There was a minute, 7 seconds left. It appeared the Jets had a big upset win. 17-14. It's not to be. O'Brien! That'll be an incomplete pass.
Now, wait a minute. Let's see. Yeah, he's going to call it an incomplete pass. Slipped out of O'Brien's hand. A strange play. As O'Brien's hand started forward, the ball slipped out of his hand.
He had El Toon going deep, and maybe at the last moment he felt he was risking an interception if he tried to go long and try to stop it. Well, he's lucky.
I don't think he tried to stop it, Dick. I think he tried to put a little bit extra on it. I think he's going to get it out there as far as he can. Watch him. Tries to whip that ball, and it just came right away from him. I don't know. That might have been a fumble. It looked like it was out early.
Looked like Garo Yepremian on that pass. Over the middle to Toon. And a first down at the 37. Offerdahl made the tackle. 17 yards for the Jets. 2 minutes and 30 seconds. No huddle. No need to really hurry here. They have all their timeouts, plus the 2 minute timeout.
Well, they may want to keep the substitutes off the field for Miami.
O'Brien throws that one where no one can catch it. He was being pressured hard by TJ Turner, rookie from Houston, number 75.
There's several reasons, Dick, to go without a huddle, one of which, with so much substitution taking place on defenses now, occasionally going without a huddle will force them to deal with or play with what they've got on the field.
That's a good point. You see that it's been Miami outscoring the Jets 24-7 in the second half. And the fumbles that have really hurt the Jets and Miami's great passing game led by Marino. Intercepted by Bud Brown, intended for Al Toon, and Mark Brown, no relation to Bud, was the man hammering O'Brien as he threw the football.
Quarterback vulnerable as he throws that football, and O'Brien, I think, either had his bell rung or got the wind knocked out of him. It was very slow getting up on that play. He's still acting rather shaky. We haven't seen O'Brien from the sideline.
There's Pat Ryan. So in a 45-38 game, it appears O'Brien's going to try to stay in.
They call the timeout to give him a breather finally.
This will count against the Jets 3, however. At least that's how Pat Haggerty signaled the timeout.
He doesn't look like he's breathing well yet as he heads to the sideline. And you see Ryan in the background. I think it's appropriate to be wearing green if you have two quarterbacks named Ryan and O'Brien.
Tonight, we're going to need a little luck of the Irish here. Meanwhile, we're waiting word on Joe Klecko as to the seriousness of that injury. We've received no official report yet.
We also have noticed that Lance Mel has been on the sideline with that ankle of his heavily taped. This has been a tough day on an already beleaguered Jet defense. And we've mentioned the injury to Hugh Green, equally difficult.
The Falcons, someone said, well, they're 2-0, but they haven't beaten anyone. They're trying to upset Dallas. The Cowboys at home, 2-point lead for the Falcons. Chris Farr has kicked another field goal for the Raiders, and San Diego leading Washington 7-3. McLowry, a field goal for Kansas City, and rushing for San Francisco.
We're going to be on at the end of some of those games. There is Klecko, and that's good news. He's up on his feet, moving around. I think if he were severely injured, you'd see several doctors and trainers crowded around. That's good news.
And we talked about the tandem of Clayton and Booker. Toon has 4 catches and Walker 3. 7 for 203 yards and 2 touchdowns. Klecko, tape knee, will be back. 3rd and 10, O'Brien, incomplete. Hector, no flag.
Kozlowski there, Bud Brown there. Kozlowski at the last second reaching in, timing his hit.
arriving with the ball. Fourth and 10, and it looks like the Jets are going to go for it with 2:06.
Well, the scoreboard shows three timeouts left, so apparently they did not charge the Jets with that injury timeout to O'Brien. The last 2 minutes they would have. And a lot of time, even if they don't make it on 4th and 10. Big play, under pressure, O'Brien to Toon. He didn't make it. Even with a second effort, he's out of bounds at the 45-yard line, short of the first down. So Miami, with 1:57 left, takes over at the Jets' 45-yard line. Now Miami and the Jets will try to use those three timeouts and stop the Dolphins. We have had it confirmed that there are three timeouts left, which is unusual because O'Brien, with timeout left the field, was allowed to continue to play the next play. Normally you have to at least exchange a player for one play if that's the case, but apparently Walton has three timeouts left. Now the Jets line will try to stop the Dolphins, hope that they can give O'Brien a desperation chance. Marino, meanwhile, sitting on a 6-touchdown game. And if they key too much on the run, he might pick them for a 7th.
They certainly have not done much with the run during this day, but with Marino in there, you've got to respect the pass, and he's not afraid to throw it in any situation. And with Shula calling the plays, you never know what's going to be called.
Joe Klecko is not in the game. Tom Baldwin is on nose tackle. Well, now it
now there's a
two timeouts. They had to charge him on the O'Brien play. Would all but do it for Miami. They have Matt Moore, wide right. Double tight end, Hardy on this side, Johnson to the right. Give it to Woody Bennett.
Fumbles!
And it goes right back to Miami. Unbelievable!
Oh.
Ben Rudolph had it fumbled right into his hands. In surprise, he could not bring it in, and it went to a Miami player down on the ground.
The one thing you look for in this situation, to get your hands back on that football, to give your offense a chance at it. The ball, watch it. Woody Bennett, or Woody goes right into the line here. The ball is hit right there. 54 is Troy Benson, and there's the ball right in the hands of Ben Rudolph, and drops it back inside.
Roy Foster on the ground, just saw the ball fall right in his lap.
Boy, talk about a turnaround.
Jets aren't calling time here, surprisingly. Clock is running.
1:43. Maybe after this play, they're going to call it. They've only got 2 left, Dick. Klecko, I guess they're not going to take a chance with that injury, but the fact that they considered him putting him back in the game would indicate that that is not a very serious injury.
Hampton stopped after
now, quick timeout. There it is.
1:18 left. One timeout remaining. It'll be 3rd and about 8 when we return to Giant Stadium. Veteran Ben Rudolph.
He's still thinking about that, having that ball in his hands and seeing it bounce back into the arms of one of the linemen, Roy Foster, on the ground,
who says luck isn't involved in this game. The 44. One timeout left for the Jets.
Pass.
Marino looking for that one more. Finds Hardy on the sidelines. And out of bounds he goes. That's a break for the Jets. He's short of the first down. And they stop the clock by knocking Hardy out of bounds after a 6-yard gain. So 4th down. And about 3. And Roby comes in to punt. And the Jets were able to save a timeout.
Plenty of time left in this ball game with a minute 11.
That unofficially was the 50th pass by Marino. No one back for the Jets. They have 11 men on the line of scrimmage. A huge unattended green. Put some pressure on Roby, but a two-step kicker, he's tough to get to, and they don't. No flag.
goes in the end zone. 1:04 left. One timeout remaining for the Jets.
Now, they did that fairly well, did they not? With only two timeouts, they actually used only 53 seconds, did Miami.
Not what you'd want to do and try to eat that clock up. Ball down on the 20-yard line. Almost the same situation that Kenny O'Brien faced last year. We mentioned it just a few minutes ago. And in that particular situation, he rallied the Jets, drove it all the way into the end zone, and completed it with a pass to Cleaver.
Jets really playing deep, and they'll go underneath to Shuler. But they need more than five-yard gains.
We have seen very little of Shuler today, and I think one of the reasons he has had a slight groin pull, and I think it's bothered him. And the other thing is that the Miami Dolphins know how much O'Brien likes to go to Shuler, and he's been one of their priority targets defensively today. They've done a pretty good job of taking him away.
Three catches, only 18 yards. It's 45-38. Miami leading, less than a minute left. One timeout left for O'Brien. To the sidelines, and a first down at the 32. 7 yards on the scramble. 49 seconds left.
Using about 10 seconds off the clock, but did pick up yardage, did pick up the first down. And again, his training not to make the mistake. They don't want him to throw the bad pass. Zone coming in with the play from the sideline.
So O'Brien can afford once, if he sees the opening, to go down the center of the field. First down.
It certainly changes the way you can play defense, too, Dick.
There he goes down the center. And then they pitch play to Hector. He's all the way to the 39, but can't get out of bounds.
He's not out of bounds. He got an injured player down, and I don't think, yes, they are going to stop it, but I think O'Brien called a timeout.
Hitch and trailer. Shuler catches the pass and pitches back to Hector, one of the oldest plays in the book.
I think Shuler is the guy who usually runs that play. In fact, they've run it quite often, and here's the toss. They fool a couple of the Dolphins here. Offerdahl is up. Kozlowski is up. But Lyle Blackwood was not fooled. And Kozlowski able to get him down inbounds. There's Shuler. Shuler took quite a shot right there. He was slow getting up. And there's Hector.
Remember in the San Diego-Miami playoff game a few years ago, that dramatic game that went overtime, it was Don Strock to Duriel Harris, who pitched to Tony Nathan for a touchdown.
A little bit of Don Shuler's own medicine being handed back by Joe Walton. Puts them in on the 39-yard line, looking in at that goal line.
Yeah, there's the situation. They need 7 to tie. They have only 35 seconds to get there, and it's a 39-yard trip. And our coordinating producer, Ted Nathanson, our director today, Andy Rosenberg, producer Larry Cirillo. Who was the script writer today?
He came straight out from Hollywood.
And O'Brien trying to make it even more dramatic. Shuler. Whoops. Oh, he fakes it, trying to get outside, and he does. He stops the clock. What an effort by Shuler. They were looking for the pitch back to Hector, and they left Shuler, and that allowed him to get out of bounds. 4 yards.
Play. Right back to the other side, but Shuler could see there was nothing to be gained from flipping it, kept it in his hands, and had to fight through a couple of tacklers to get out of bounds. Watch him at the end of this play. He can see there's no gain here. They got a piece of him too early. Kozlowski, no way he was going to take the bite a second time. But there's Shuler. One man, two men on him. Bud Brown, the last guy to get a piece of him. Don McNeil, second man on him.
Second and 5. O'Brien to the sidelines. Shuler, but he doesn't get out of bounds. And now they'll have to hurry. The ball is at the 20-yard line.
16, 15, 14. It's counting down. They're lined up. They'll get it out of bounds. Good, smart, quick play. But we're in the last few heartbeats of this game, Dick.
Well, they have one chance. Very difficult to get a play in less than 5 seconds. You don't want to risk that. So it's going to be one play at a time. Yeah, he's been busy. Crazy Joe Costanza, our statistician. We want to thank our help in the group, Mike Elver, Dan Regan, Jim McLaughlin, Ron Zipkowski. The ball sits on the 20-yard line, and this is the play. Set in by the man who calls it, Joe Walton. Tony Page, the messenger, gives it to O'Brien. And 5 seconds to tie it up.
Playoff.
Tune out of bounds, but clearly that is when they should because that was a fumble. And herein is that whole dragnet. The instant replay, while it's a good idea, frankly isn't working.
Here's a better angle of it, and you can see the ball broken loose before the runner is down.
No question, that's a fumble.
The Jets, with a quick huddle and a quick play, beat the system on that one.
O'Brien, Tatum, two for two. He's at the 46-yard line. Another first down. Well, the rulings have been made when the evidence didn't seem to be conclusive, and here it would appear as quite obvious evidence that he is not down. The ball is clearly out of his grasp before he hits the ground, and Miami recovers the football.
I think the Jets would say they lost one early. They picked one up here. Maybe it's even down on the day. I don't know. Miami's not going to be happy, Dick.
First down, Jets. 1 minute into overtime. Tied at 45. Woody Page. He has good yardage to, except that Tony Page, the one to call him Woody. Tony Page to the 47.
Got the legs that look like tree trunks, yeah, I tell you.
Thanks for trying to cover it. But, Pat Leahy, who has not missed for quite some time. 15 straight for Leahy. Anticipated. Second down. Four. Most of the crowd standing. Hector.
Whoa.
Boy, he has quick feet, doesn't he? First down at the Miami 43. And the Jets driving closer and closer to field goal range.
Marino wants his shot on the sideline. He knows that all it takes is a field goal or a touchdown. Any points on the board, and he's not going to have a shot at it. I tell you, Dick, you've got to pass some bouquets out to the offensive line of the Jets. Dan Alexander has been in there all day with a bad back. And those guys have been down in the trenches knocking it out, doing a fine job in there.
Take to Hector. O'Brien going for it all to Walker. Touchdown. Oh, my.
Pointing. Crash Jensen in there saying, our ball. The Jets quickly huddled up. Maybe the smartest play of the day. Got a playoff before anybody could buzz down from the replay booth, and then went right down the field. Two quick strikes to Al Two.